Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind anyone using an electronic device to please switch it to silent. We begin today with a roundtable on the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill, and today's session will focus on one of the key objectives of the bill, which is the adoption and the use of sustainable regenerative agricultural practices. However, our discussion will have the opportunity to branch out into wider aspects of the bill. We've scheduled 2.5 hours for this session, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Dr. Liz Baron-Mayeka from the director from Lantra Scotland. We have Nigel Miller, the co-chair from Farming for 1.5. We've got Professor Cathy Dwyer, the chair of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission and Professor of Animal and Veterinary Sciences at SRUC. We have Dave Mackay, the head of policy from the Soil Association in Scotland. Dr. Lorna Cole, a senior consultant from SRUC. With Ross Payton, who's the chair of the Scottish Organic Stakeholders Group. Dr. Tara Wright, the Policy and Campaigns Coordinator for the Land Workers Alliance for Scotland. And Dr. Eva, sorry, I beg your pardon, Vera Eri from SRUC. And we've also got Kirsty Jenkins, the Policy Officer for One Kind, and Donald McKinnon, the chair of the Scottish Crofters Federation, joining us remotely. So, as per tradition, I'm going to kick off with a general question. So, what I would like is your views on what the adoption of the use of sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices, what are the objectives? Who would like to kick off with their views on that?
I'm an agricultural ecologist and I've been working in this field for about 30 years, understanding the interactions between agriculture and our natural resources and how these two aspects are inherently linked, how they work together and how they need to work together, yet our natural resources have been depleted. I've been advocating what I would call agroecology, but I know the terminologies change and regenerative agriculture is right. I do think we need to make this work for all farmers. And if you are a farmer with a high nature value system, you may feel excluded because you aren't required to regenerate anything. Your land is healthy, your ecosystems are supporting agriculture. If you are an arable farmer and things are too prescriptive, you're not allowed to till, for example, then you may feel excluded. So I think we need to ensure that the terminology is properly explained. It's not defined in the way agroecology is. It's used in many different ways. So it needs a proper definition, and that definition needs to include all of our farming community.
How are we going to do that in the face of the bill? You know, sustainable and regenerative means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. So how on earth, and a piece of legislation, we're going to narrow the definitions down so it's actually useful for farmers to shape the way that they farm in the future?
I think that's where your accompanying code needs to be properly written. It needs to involve a wide range of stakeholders. And if that code's sound, then, and it's linked to in the bill, then that's an appropriate way.
Okay. Dave Mackay.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I think that the bill, as drafted, requires ministers to produce the code, but we would question, I guess, what the legal basis of that might be and how it might be applied. So as Dr. Cole said, there are many definitions of regenerative agriculture, In our submission to this committee, we picked up the groundswell definition, which is essentially five principles around minimising soil disturbance, keeping the soil surface covered, maintaining living roots in the soil, growing a diverse range of crops, and bringing grazing animals back to land. So those are quite broad principles and not particularly prescriptive, but I think it's fair to say at the minute there's a real energy and momentum around the regenerative agriculture movement, not just here in Scotland, but across the world, and I think that's a very good thing. It means that farmers are thinking about their systems, are thinking about soil health and fertility, and I think there are many parallels with the regenerative movement and the agroecological and organic approaches to farming, which are also based on whole farm systems, soils, recycling nutrients, etc. So I think it's going to be important for Scottish Government to define what it thinks that sustainable and regenerative means. I would agree with you, it would be quite difficult to do that in the face of the bill, but our understanding of the code is that that will be the conduit for government to explain the methods and approaches that it considers to represent sustainable regenerative agriculture, and for those to be supported through the four-tier system going forward.
So in your opinion, you seem to be suggesting that there's not actually a definition, but it's a route, or it shows ways to get to a desired goal. So it's more or less defining what the desired goal is rather than the practices in practice, if you like.
Well, I think if you look at what's been published already in terms of the proposed approaches that might be supported through Tier 2 of the new structure, there's plenty in there, some of which many farmers will already be doing, and that might be reducing tillage, it might be direct drilling, it might be having wildflower margins and arable systems, it might be wood pasture for livestock systems. So I think these are all examples of what we would consider an approach and a shift towards the sustainable farming approaches that the government said it wants to deliver through the Vision for Agriculture. But I suppose the question is, what is this code of practice going to be for? Is it going to have a legal basis? Are these principles going to form, for example, the basic requirements under Tier 1? So we would suggest that if everybody is shifting in that direction, so if the majority of farmers are adopting these approaches, and that's a step in the right direction, and then beyond that baseline, if you like, for regenerative, for those that want to go further, there's organic certification, there's other models out there as well.
OK. Nigel Miller.
Thanks very much. I mean, I really like the first two contributions. I would totally agree with them. But I guess that I have a real bit of an issue about this being part of a vision, because it's actually about your management practices which actually deliver something beyond that. And it's what agriculture is trying to deliver beyond that should be the vision, which is presumably low carbon production, which is sustainable. But also, if you look at the climate change report, we've actually got to produce 22% more for 20% more food if we're going to continue to produce the same amount of food per capita with population growth, and that's often forgotten. And we've got really pretty extreme or challenging emission targets to meet as well. And regenerative farming is a really key component of actually creating the platform for that sort of farming. But it's not an end point, and it's different on every farm. What you're going to apply and what you're going to do and what is actually going to give value is going to be different on every farm. And really the one common part or outcome of regenerative farming probably is maintaining soil biodiversity and soil carbons, and actually managing your soils within the recommended bracket for that soil type and that sort of production system. And that's something that is meaningful and you can aim at as a farmer, and it actually sets some direction for your actual enterprise and your management. Actually coming up with some sort of vision that regenerative and sustainable farming is what we're aiming for, in practical terms, on everyday farms, is almost meaningless, because a lot of people are already doing these things. And the other thing about regenerative farming is, on most systems, including organic, you have regenerative phases and you have exploitative phases. That's the reality. So you go up and down as far as the actual key parameters are concerned. And that, again, you seem to, the regenerative seems to suggest we're going to be regenerating all the time. We're not. we're going to be exploiting at times as well. So I think the term is actually quite difficult. And I think for farmers, you want something pretty black and white. And to me, managing your soil carbons within recommending brackets looks like a target that you could actually aim for and be comfortable that you could manage and go for.
Can I press you a little bit more on that? So how can progress to becoming more regenerative and sustainable actually be measured, monitored and evaluated? Mm-hmm. Are we, so looking at the legislation, you know, we're at the business end of the bill now, where we're looking at you know, amendments or whatever potentially coming forward. How can the bill ensure that those objectives are met?
You know, to me, you know, the one objective measure that you can make is actually, you know, monitoring soil health and soil carbons. And it's not, you know, subjective, it's actually an objective indicator. And with your information from, or the backup of the scientists, and I suppose particularly Hutton and SRUC, you know, they can actually define you know, carbon levels for certain soil types and certain systems that you should aim at. And that gives you something solid to work with.
Thank you. I've got Dr. Tara Wright and then Ross Payton.
Yeah, I think I agree with a lot of what's been said already. I think when it comes to defining sustainable and regenerative agriculture, there is already a lot out there. As David said, the groundswell definition, which involves the five principles, is pretty comprehensive, and it's also really widely accepted across different parts of the farming movement, the more conventional and the more kind of organic agroecological farming movement. So I think that this is one of the areas where the kind of more sustainable end of the farming movement is really ahead of policy. You know, this stuff is happening on farms. We have really good evidence for what practices are helping to regenerate nature, store carbon. You know, so I think taking a lead from what's going on in the regenerative farming movement already is important. I think there's definitely should be some space for, like, to some extent it is a process and a set of objectives, but those need to be quite clearly defined, because there are lots of different ways to achieve that, and it's important that farmers have some kind of autonomy over that. It will look different in different systems. We kind of need a diverse approach to make sure that, you know, we don't want to make a mistake, tell everyone to do something now and it turns out not to be the best thing in this Scottish context or in some other contexts. So I think, yeah, some flexibility with really clearly defined sort of parameters and outcomes. I also think that it is worth, I think, yeah, the regenerative farming movement has gained a lot of momentum and it's a really useful term to be using. I think there's some things from the idea of agroecology that are missing from the regenerative concept that it would be worth trying to include. So agroecology looks a little more broadly than just at the farming practices, but more how they tie into the whole system. So I do think we need to be thinking about the food system, not just the practices on farm. You know, what are we making healthy, sustainable food that ties in with Good Food Nation? And that should be really central in this bill as well. And how are we producing that food in a way that is good for nature and good for the climate? So I think tying into the food system, but also into a more kind of justice angle as well. How is that food system working for the people in Scotland? How is the regenerative farming system working for the farmers and the people producing the food? Is it fair to them? Is the payment system allowing people to transition in a way that is just? And I think that if there's a way to include some of that kind of broader picture in a definition of regenerative and sustainable rather than just this practice stores more carbon, I think that's quite important when looking at a broader picture of transforming the agricultural system.
Okay. I'm going to bring in Ross, but could you also maybe consider in your contribution, again, we're looking at legislation now, we're at the business end of the work we're doing, where we're actually looking at words and legislations and rules and laws and whatever. How do we make sure this bill, whether it on the face of the bill or certainly legislation, delivers this vision, Ross?
Well, you pointed out when you came to the farm visit that an awful lot of the environmental schemes of the past, they weren't really, the outcomes weren't measured. You ticked the box and you did it and you got your money and that was the end of it. And I think you need to measure outcomes of these things a bit more accurately. And one of them is the soils. I mean, we got CATIF funding, and my other role is the chair of the Scottish Organic Milk Producers. We got CATIF funding and we're doing soil carbon analysis as part of that. So we've got a baseline to measure against. So I think your point when you're at the farm is quite a good one. A lot of stuff done, hedgerows planted. And anecdotally, of course, there's a lot more bird life, but we need to measure that. You need to be able to see actual progress and actual things happen. And I think one of the aims I would like to see is getting a much more circular economy on farms where there's, you know, yes, there's an exploitative stage, but like an organic system, you're supposed to be trying to keep as much as possible in that particular holding and not having too much export or not enough regeneration.
So how do we actually do that? How do we legislate for it? Because I say we've done all the talking.
We
know the direction of travel.
You have to say, well, you're starting this, you must measure it at the end of it. Because otherwise you'll get a lot of greenwashing and what going on, calling themselves regenerative. If you don't measure it, you have to have the legislation that after, I mean, 3 years, I mean, I did the climate change thing with SRUC and there was a 3-year scheme and that's nothing like long enough. I think it's a 10-year time span you're looking at. And the legislation has to say there has to be progress within 10 years. I mean, looking at the climate, it's really getting quite serious and biodiversity loss is getting more and more serious. You have to see a reversal of that in real terms.
Thank you. Professor Cathy Dyer.
Thank you, Chair. And I've really appreciated all the contributions from others. And there's nothing I disagree with, but I wanted to pick up and really expand on what Dr. Wright said about making this broader, because I think we've talked a lot about soils and systems, and most of these systems also have animals involved in them. And we haven't, and there's very little in the bill actually about animals and animal welfare in particular, which obviously you'd expect me to want to talk about, but I think it is really important. There's some high-level statements about animal welfare, but if you drill down into the bill, none of the objectives really explicitly talk about animals very much at all. And it's often assumed to be part of sustainability or high-quality foods, but I think unless we have something very concrete that explains that how animals live their lives, how they interact with the environment, how they interact with people, actually. Often there's very close contact between good animal welfare and good livelihoods and worker well-being. Then I think we miss some opportunities, and I think there's always a worry that animal welfare sort of disappears with some of these other higher-level concerns. So I would like to see more thought around animal welfare, how we can sustain and improve animal welfare within the context of sustainability.
When you say more thought, would you like to see something on the face of the bill which directly...
I would, yes. Yeah, I think I would like to... Well, personally, I would like to see an objective that talks about at least maintaining, but ideally improving animal welfare. We're seeing there's a lot more research that's coming along that could integrate into opportunities to improve animal lives, which will actually improve sustainability. There's very good evidence now of a relationship between the two.
Okay, thank you. On the same topic, we've got Kirsty Jenkins.
Thank you, convener, and hello to everybody in the room. And I'm sorry I can't be with you in person. I would definitely echo everything that Cathy Dwyer has just said. I think given that there are millions of animals in our food system, it was quite a startling omission that animal welfare was not listed as one of the key objectives on the bill. And I think it is and should be treated as a standalone priority. And it's also very much linked to the well-being of humans and the natural world. It's something that the public care about. In the recently published Our Food Report by Food Standards Scotland and the Food Standard Agency, animal welfare was the second most reported concern related to food, with 81% of the respondents. We would like to see it as a standalone objective in the bill. And I think it definitely should be part of the definition of regenerative agriculture. We were glad to see that it was improving animal welfare was listed as one of the goals of regenerative agriculture in the route map. And that should be carried over into the code of practice. I think that a lot of people practicing what might be called regenerative agriculture do very much recognise that animal welfare is integrated into that. Pasture for Life Association, for example, very clearly state on their website the benefits that they see to animals and living in their systems, and that includes the lack of behavioural restriction and production diseases that are problems in some of the more intensive systems. Equally, it's not guaranteed, and it can be assumed that animal welfare is going to be better in any given system. And so it's important that it is very much built into the definition in the code of practice.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Ask Kirsty Jenkins what areas of animal welfare you are concerned about, because obviously the farming sector is highly regulated in terms of farm assurance schemes, and you said that consumers are concerned particularly around animal welfare when it comes to food production. What specific areas are you thinking of?
There are obviously concerns for all animals in all systems. What I mentioned were relating to the more intensive systems. As I said, there are production diseases, and these are health conditions that are linked to the ways that animals are bred and the environments they're raised in. To give an example, chickens raised for meat, who are commonly called broilers, they've been selectively bred for decades now for fast growth and improved feed conversion. And what that means is that they do grow very fast. Their cardiovascular systems struggle to keep pace with that fast growth. So what we see is that these birds, near the end of their lives, they have a lot of cardiovascular diseases. There are problems with their mobility. There are leg disorders. There's a lot of pain associated with that. And then linked to the environment they're living in, because they have mobility problems, they'll spend a lot more time sitting or lying. And so they can get breast blisters or hock burns from the ammonia in the litter. So that's just one example. There are similar concerns for laying hens, pigs and dairy cows, all linked to the way that animals are selectively bred and raised for food. Like I say, the concerns are wide-ranging. And as I said, some of those will possibly be mitigated in outdoor extensive and regenerative systems, but that needs to be explicitly looked at and considered. Someone mentioned measurements and assessments, and I think animal welfare outcome assessments should be very much a part of agricultural policy.
Okay. Professor Cathy Dyer.
I wanted to add to that. There are farm assurance systems or schemes that try to improve welfare, and they do, but often they're voluntary. It's still very evident, if you look at farms, that there are huge variation in animal welfare. So Kirsty's described the situation for broilers, but we know that there is 30% lameness, for example, in dairy cows, and lameness is about pain. So we've got large numbers of animals that are potentially in pain. We still allow surgical procedures to be carried out on animals, young animals without anaesthesia and analgesia, things that we would never allow with our companion animals. So there's still issues that happen across our farming systems that that most consumers would be concerned about from a welfare perspective, from the animals' experiences, the animals' suffering. We still have systems that constrict animals, confine animals into colony cages or in farrowing crates, and these are areas that there's increasing concern globally. So more and more countries are moving away from the use of these systems, particularly in the global north. And if we sort of sit back and think we have great animal welfare, we're going to be left behind by some of these countries.
Dr. Tara White.
Yeah, I wanted to come in just a little bit on the... We've been talking a bit about the objectives of the bill, which is obviously slightly separate than the definition of regenerative and sustainable, but I think they tie together, because that code of practice will obviously be developed in the context of this framework, which sets out the objectives. I think from our perspective, the objectives are good. We really agree with all of them, but it's a very restrictive list. Especially in comparison to when you look at the most recent CAP legislation, which has 10 really quite thorough objectives that cover a much wider range of things. I think the nature and climate crisis are such that they probably deserve their own objectives to count as objectives individually rather than kind of lumped together. and a whole lot of issues around just like farmers' wages, supporting generational renewal, all those kind of things are not included in the objectives, which I do think are really important. So I think that if there's a way that this committee can have another look at those objectives and how we can make that more comprehensive, that's really important, and that ties in a lot with this kind of definition of regenerative and sustainable, and how that how that code of practice will play a part. The other thing I just wanted to say was, I think we've talked a bit about how the kind of difficult it is to define regenerative because it's so broad, and you know, potentially a set of principles and looking at soil health and biodiversity and these kind of things. I do think it's worth noting that there are practices we know are not regenerative, and there's currently nothing really in the bill about how, you know, sort of targets to phase out practices that we know are bad for nature and the climate. For example, there's nothing around reducing pesticide use, for example, and I think that could be an approach to take, would be looking at some of these things that we specifically know are bad for nature and climate. That would be a useful approach.
Dave Mackay.
Yes, just very quickly on that point about the EU CAP objectives. So Scottish Government has a policy to remain aligned as closely as practicable with changes to EU policy and legislation. And in the policy memorandum, there was reference to moving away from the current CAP schemes, but staying aligned on outcomes. So I think on that basis, I would agree with what Tara is saying, and specifically within those 10 CAP objectives, there's one on animal health and welfare, which has already been covered by other witnesses, and I think that's very important. There's also one around efficient natural resource management, so thinking about how we manage soils and water. And the third, and this is one that was flagged in the evidence submission by SAOS, and we've backed their call for inclusion of strengthening the position of farmers in the value chain as an objective of the legislation. I think it's very clear there are enormous cost pressures on farmers, there's extreme weather, and there's imbalances in the market. So I think if that could be an objective of the legislation, then that might help for future policy to help in that regard.
Thank you. Donald McKinnon.
Thank you, Convener, and apologies I can't be with you in person today, but thanks for inviting me to join. Just going back to the definitions of the regenerative and sustainable agriculture, I think one of the dangers around going into the definitions of these areas is that things get left out, things that we think should be included, and areas that we think should be supported going forward. SAF has used a slightly different term in the past to describe the kind of practices that we want to see supported going forward and that we think are important, and that's high nature value farming. And in saying that, I'm not suggesting that we introduce a new term to this objective, but I think it's just important to recognise that once we go into, and some of the discussion that we've heard this morning, some people have described the regenerative definitions as being quite broad, but actually at times they can be quite narrow, and I worry sometimes that we could be getting to a point where we exclude some of the really important practices that go on, particularly in some of the areas that we represent in the crofting counties. And I'm thinking of some of the practices in the cropping and the machers in Uist, and also extensive grazing of livestock, and just making sure that these are recognised as for the importance that they do around biodiversity and delivering on what I think the objectives here are trying to outline, but just making sure that those don't get lost. And just while I'm speaking, to talk about the objectives of the bill in the round and where there may be some areas missing. Like Tara said, I think the objectives are quite tight and narrow, and there probably is some room for a few more to be added in there. We think that there could be something specific about promoting small-scale agriculture and making it very clear that the agricultural policy does have a role in supporting that. And also what something else that Sarah said about fair income as well, that there should be a commitment to ensuring fair income for farmers and crofters, and that should be a key outcome of the bill as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Donald. Just to wrap up this first question, so it's all very well having codes of conduct, codes of practice, good practice and so on, but how do we actually get that adopted in the ground by farmers? How do they pick it up? So links to CPD, how do we initiate that? So I'm probably going to look to my right here with CPD.
With Donald McKinnon.
Yeah, very briefly.
It's just what you were saying there. I just wondered how you could achieve that, what you've just talked about, through the lens of the bill, or would you be looking at something through secondary legislation?
I think in relation to my first point about things that could be excluded or additions to the objectives.
Such as fair work, such as supporting small holdings, supporting crofters, and the things that you just talked about.
Mm-hmm. Well, it could be a combination of the two. I think there could be a role for making that one of the objectives of the bill, so that it's front and centre, and that ultimately this committee and the Parliament are able to hold the government to account on delivering on that. I think the actual implementation of it will have to be through policy and through secondary legislation. But I think it is important that it's given the focus that it needs, that making sure that that these key areas of the agricultural sector are supported, and that the policy is trying to aim for all farmers and crofters to be able to be rewarded adequately for the work that they're doing in delivering high quality food production, but also all the other outcomes that the agricultural policy is looking for, and that they're supported effectively.
Thank you. Back to looking at CPD and just how documents that potentially sit on the shelf, how that we get farmers to adopt them. I'm going to ask Dr. Liz Bazant-Yerrick, to come in on that from Lantra.
Thank you. I don't think there's any complicated problem that the skills system can't make more complicated. So in this situation, you've got, if I use the analogy of changing a plug, it would be you'd have different wiring in different areas of Scotland and different plugs for different outputs. And the consumer knowing that there's lots of different plugs but not what works in which situation. And equally, all the plugs and the wiring could change very rapidly. So the CPD, the courses, the training that you have to offer is not going to be one size fits all. There isn't going to be one course, one CPD programme that every farmer individual can do. So that makes things a little bit more complicated. There are a very wide variety of different CPD opportunities out there. We've been gathering them together on the Skills Hub, skillshub.scot. So you can see there's different training there. In terms of the uptake, it tends to be new entrants that are looking for the training and the short courses. There's not so much from people who are already established in the system. So I do think that the bill's recommendation of being able to make CPD mandatory is a very good idea. But you need both the kind of carrot and stick approach, I think, in order to support people to take it up. Equally, when you're offering the CPD, there's the CPD itself, its content. You've got the way that it's delivered, how you find it, how you fund it, how you facilitate that CPD. Then there's the accreditation of the person who's delivering it, but also the content of the CPD, and how you ensure and monitor the uptake as well. So I say it does make things more complicated. But I think that there are some really good examples of practice out there. You're not having to start from scratch, but making sure that it's flexible enough that farmers who are already established and doing things really well can look at next steps and next approaches for their own business. But equally, there's support for the ones that are beginning on that journey of change.
Okay. Rachel Hamilton.
Liz, you talked about carrot and stick. Mm-hmm. So would there be aspects of CPD that Lantra believed should be both compulsory and voluntary?
I think there's stages involved. You can see that with many of the other courses that we've developed, where they start out as being voluntary. and then they become compulsory. So they start out being voluntary, for example, for some courses, muir burn training has recently been developed in partnership with the Fire and Rescue Service. It's got a good uptake. At some point, that will probably be a kind of legislative requirement. It might be useful for that to be mandatory at some point in the future. But it depends upon the outcomes. And I think a lot with the CPD, it's going to be linked to what are you measuring, which comes back to the objectives. So why would somebody do that course? If they do it because it's going to improve their outcomes, there's an incentive for doing it there. If it's about health and safety, then that's a different thing. And I think maybe that we would be looking more at the mandatory route for those. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Kirsty Jenkins. And then...
Thanks, Convener. I actually had requested to speak on a previous point, but I will pick up on CPD as well. I just wanted to build a little bit on what myself and Cathy were saying earlier about animal welfare, because I think it's important to make sure we know what we mean when we're talking about animal welfare. We've been quite worried about the sort of way animal welfare has been discussed in the lead up to this bill, and especially in the Scottish Government consultation documents. It seemed to be that they'd taken quite a narrow definition of welfare, which was more relating to health and biological functioning, and especially as that relates to other outcomes like emissions reduction, productivity and so on. When we speak of animal welfare, and I think the consensus amongst animal welfare scientists now, is that mental state and the animal's experience of the world is the key component, and Cathy did touch on that a little bit, but I just wanted to really say that quite clearly, that what we mean when we say animal welfare is important as well. And I think that more holistic, modern definition of animal welfare is what we should be working towards. That does relate to what you were saying about CPD, because I think, that modern, holistic sort of definition and way of thinking of animal welfare needs to be built into CPD. And I think there are already things happening that are really beneficial for animal welfare. For example, I know that a lot of people who practice what would come under the umbrella of regenerative use low stress handling techniques. And I think that's obviously something that should be built on and built into CPD. From what I've heard, the monitor farms are really valuable. So, for example, as I understand it, a lot of pig farmers are now becoming much more positive about the idea of potentially moving away from farrowing crates, as long as that transition is properly managed. And that's partly because, as some farmers do it, and they can see their friends and neighbours sort of see the systems in practice and working, that really sort of builds confidence that it is possible.
Thank you, Kirsty. Alistair Allen.
Just for clarity before I begin, I don't know if other members have had much chance to speak yet, some have, but I was wanting in, so I'll make that point. If I can ask about the point that's been made, and others have touched on it, I realise, but the definition of sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices. I mean, we've talked around this in the context of other legislation as well. I mean, there is this balancing act to be done about what goes on the face of the bill in terms of definitions, and then what's flexible enough to avoid either emission exemption or exclusion by emission in a list, or to avoid a situation where the government has to continually come back to Parliament to change legislation every time there's a demand for it to do something new. So how do you get that balance right when defining in the bill the definition of sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices?
Ross Payton.
I'm bound to say, as a representative of the organic sector, that the organic movement provides you with a legally binding set of standards that tick a large number of boxes. And we get a bit frustrated that the government seems to treat organics as a bit of a kind of byline, and we don't get the recognition we deserve for doing a lot of these things already. And one of the things we'd like to see is, as the previous support schemes did, they give you a buy to tier 2 and 3 if you're an organic farmer automatically because you're deemed to be doing those things. But Soil Association, SOPA and the other certification bodies are doing the job for you. You know, they're certifying you, us for you, for us, and it's legally binding. It's there, and how you define all the other things, I don't know. It's very, very difficult. You have to have certification of some description, although the outcomes-based thing would be certainly one way of looking at it. But, you know, the organic standards provide you with a basis in which a lot of these things you're looking for are already being done.
Thank you. Dr. Cole.
I wouldn't want to dismiss the organic sector, but I think it is very prescriptive because of the actions they're not allowed to do. And for that reason, I like regenerative more. I think Tara's absolutely right. There's many different definitions. A lot of these definitions focus beyond the five principles of soil health. So I think we need to recognise the wider ecosystem services that are provided. Out in farm, I'm always amazed at the pockets of habitats and the species these habitats support. So our farmland is connecting nature reserves. It's creating corridors throughout our countryside. If we focus on the key elements of soil health, they're very prescriptive and they're very arable focused. If we take it back to the basics, living roots, minimum tillage, covering the soil, integrating livestock, these are all things livestock farmers are doing. So from that, they're excluded. I'd say wider definitions, I would take a holistic view. It's maintaining the ecosystem services, enhancing them. It's taking it beyond the farm gate. It's looking at local food chains. It's getting every person to recognise where the food comes from. If there is a loss in yield, how do we support that? How do we help people transition? How do we get people to pay for those goods? They're not buying a steak. They're buying a steak that doesn't capture carbon, but they're buying the system. They're buying the butterflies that are in that meadow. They're buying the carbon that's locked up in the hedgerow. It's recognising that the food they are paying for isn't just something they eat, and also diets, food waste, etc.
OK, thanks. We've got Dr. White, Dr. Urey and Nigel Miller.
I was going to come in back on the CPD point. Is that
OK? Yes.
Or shall I... Do we want to stick to this?
Well, actually, what we'll do, we'll stick to that point we're on at the moment, and we can come back at the end of the question.
Great.
Dr. Urey.
Thank you, Covenant. Thank you for all the previous points. What this discussion is really revealing, as we know, that it's a very diverse sector. And in my opinion, with such a framework bill, what we can probably do usefully is to stick to the high-level objectives of biodiversity, water pollution, air pollution, climate change, and probably linking it with land use, land demand, and what it means globally and in the UK and Scotland, because prescribing actions on the farm might be counterproductive. So it's a fine balance. It's a little bit like if we prescribed everyone to have electric cars just from tomorrow. Instead, we prescribe it at the UK level or national level. However, what I would like to also point out is that the farm level required changes might be better to be result-based, outcome-based, as we heard before. And we also have to think about the coverage of the bill, because right now it seems that it's going to cover those people, farmers, landowners, managers, who decide to be in the subsidy system, not anyone else. And depending on the money flows and so on, more and more farmers might decide to get out of the system. Do we have any leverage on what they do? Do we want to tell them somehow to go this direction or that direction. So that's an important point, and it links a lot with land use and land use change. The Climate Change Committee recently said in a report that by 2050 in the UK we need to change land use so that agricultural land use need to be reduced by 21%, and by 2030 by 9%. If that's going to change, then again, that area, will that be included in the bill or in other legislation? How we deal with those, and how we deal with those farmers and landowners and managers who decide to go into other land use? So these are really important, and especially important to in reaching net zero targets.
Yeah, I'm going to come to Nigel Miller and back to Alison Allan.
Thanks very much. I think quite a few of the points that I were concerned about Vera's actually touched on, but I think that you know, if we look at definitions, they've got to be for everybody. You know, that's the reality. And I think that if you're looking at definitions or looking at nice to have initiatives, you've actually got to still remember what we've got to deliver in the long term. One is more food, and that's quite difficult given that our land area is actually falling. The other one, I suppose, immediately is if you look at what we've signed up to as a country is emission reduction, and one of those is obviously methane reduction, but also general reduction of emissions, which is quite challenging. 30-30 commitments to wildlife, which is actually going to take land out of production in agricultural area. 70% of our land is under agricultural tenure. If you have 30% under biodiversity management, then your production potential is going to fall. This is almost a revolution. This is a bigger revolution than we've faced ever. It's bigger than what we faced in the 1940s. Agriculture is going to change really significantly. Now, I've got no problem at all with having a vibrant organic sector which is well supported. It's a, you know, a really, you know, positive concept. But the reality is, if we're looking at sustainability and regenerative farming, it's got to be accessible to everybody, and we're going to have some farms which are actually very productive in food terms. And we're going to have some farms which actually do deliver on sequestration and on biodiversity. There's going to be two strands you're going to have there. And these basic definitions have actually got to apply to them all. And if you're looking at regenerative farming, we need to have... micromanaging is going to be impossible. If we're going to make these changes, there's got to be flexibility there for farmers to innovate and also adopt new techniques, but also, I suppose, fit systems to their actual geographic and climatic and soil conditions. And you can't micromanage that. So really, if you're looking at definitions, that soil carbon one is critical. If you're looking at regenerative practice, you've really got to go really basic, looking at having rotations on cropping systems, and looking at, you know, legumes or diverse swards, and making those a baseline requirement. Don't go any further than that, otherwise you'll destroy the industry. And I think you'll also soak away the industry is disillusioned, finds this process difficult, feels powerless, and in many ways is declining. This bill, as well as being enabling as far as legislation, has actually got to be a signpost that there is a future and there's something, you know, positive ahead. There's real challenges, but you need farmers to actually, you know, accept those challenges and give you the solutions, not micromanage them into submission. And I think there's a real danger of that in this process, and it's already started. And that's, you know, spills over onto CPD. The 1.5 group did write a lot about training and CPD and different methodologies and trying to reach people that don't normally have the time or the ability to get to training. But I think there's a starting point. A lot of farmers, or most farmers, are very professional. If this is a profession, the profession itself should be deciding what CPD is available and giving people choices of what to do. It shouldn't be imposed top-down from anybody saying, well, you guys need a bit of training, then you'll change. The reason farmers haven't changed is there's no bloody route map to change to, and we don't know what's going to be acceptable. Even on things like emissions and mitigation measures, we don't know whether that should be in the inventory. So people are adopting some of these, spending money, and they're not counting the bloody inventory. Now, your government's got an obligation here to actually be upfront about what the targets are, but also facilitate change by actually, you know, having, you know, some sort of pointers, but also that underpinning of information which allows people to take decisions. All these mitigation and regenerative techniques actually cost money. If you have a legume-based rotation, which is probably something you want to have, if you look at it in financial terms, what it gains you, it's negative. It's a cost. So we're looking at higher costs. If you look at SEALs and SACs
work...
It's not just about nitrogen use, and it's also about your total output from that farm and the actual crop values you get. And that's what, in the end, matters. And the reality is that inflation has already eroded 30% from the support system. So we're a less supported sector. So this is a crisis time or a real challenge. I don't really like using that wording, but it's an extraordinary challenge that we're facing, and trying to micromanage the industry isn't helpful.
OK. I'm going to give you the right to reply very briefly.
I want to ask Nigel, you said we need to produce more food. Where's the evidence for that? That is a trope here all the time. We need to produce higher quality food. Producing more food for whom? To oversupply already oversupplied commodity market? Or we're not feeding the third world here. You won't feed the world with suckler cows, that's for one thing.
I think that comes simply from the land use change report from the UK Climate Change Committee. And they came up with a very basic calculation, which was if we're actually going to produce the same amount of food per capita in the UK, we need to increase our production by 20%. Now, there's quite a lot in that report that I might dispute, but that's just a figure crunching exercise. And the reality is, if you look at food supply and look at what we use just now, we use a lot of vegetables and fruit from Spain. Those areas now have eroded their groundwater. They can't grow those two or three crops a year. They can't supply the UK. Likewise, if you look at California, it's in the same place. Look at parts of Australia and New Zealand, where extreme climate events gives you fluctuations of production. Mm-hmm. And look at the level of starvation or food deprivation in all sorts of developing countries. It's irresponsible to actually suggest that we don't need to produce more food.
Okay, we're drifting a bit off the bill. I'm going to pull it back in. I'm going to ask Alistair for his supplementary thing and move on.
Thank you, convener. It was mentioned by Donald and by Vera there as well, I think, as well, talking about brought in what... I'm going to put words in their mouths, but I think they were talking about low-intensity agriculture and the value of it in terms of legislation that defines sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices. I wonder, maybe this one's aimed at Donald, but I wonder if you can just explain to us where Crofting fits into that picture of low-intensity agriculture and what crofters are already doing to achieve some of these aims around regenerative agriculture.
Thanks, Alistair. As I said earlier on, I think it's just important that we recognise some of these existing practices that are happening on the ground. So the example I used there was of cropping in the machers in Uist. Now, that's quite a unique system that's an integration of both arable production, but very closely linked with beef cattle. The one wouldn't happen without the other. But the impact of that system, which I would argue is a very sustainable one, it makes use of seaweed that's washed up on the shore to provide the nutrients that grow the crops that are then fed to the cattle. That system does a huge amount for the biodiversity in that area, providing habitat for some of our rarest species, such as the corncrake. And lots of other red list species that inhabit that area. If that part of the industry becomes, if any element of that system becomes unsupported or unable to continue, then that process falls apart. And the important thing to think about there as well is the cultural significance of that, the importance of that to that community. To the Gaelic language as well in that area too. So we have to be incredibly careful that we take those really, really fragile systems with us as this policy is developed and as this system is developed, That's just one example, and there's plenty others throughout the Crofton counties of other quite unique approaches, and some not so unique that would translate into other types of upland agriculture and hill farming across the rest of the country. But that extensive livestock system and the integration between that and people, communities, culture, but also biodiversity and how reliant some of our most threatened species are, and just clinging on really in some of these areas where these traditional agricultural practices are continuing. So we can't become blinkered by just looking at emissions and carbon. It's very, very important, you know, that dealing with the climate crisis has to be top of the agenda. But we need to make sure that we're taking a holistic approach to this and looking at all these other things that are important and can't lose sight of. So thanks.
Thank you,
Convener. Dr. White.
I'm going to move on to my point in CPD in just a second. I just wanted to come back a little bit on what Nigel was saying, and just to say that from the Land Workers Alliance perspective, we take a very different view on this kind of idea of two strands approach, and I do think it's important for that when we're thinking about the bill that there are these two kind of schools of thought, that actually we don't need to have intense production on some farms and biodiversity on others, that we can have both, you know, both those things can coexist. At the moment, our most productive farms in terms of land use are small-scale horticulture, so fruit and vegetable production, market gardens. They sequester lots of carbon, they're great for biodiversity, and you can feed 100 families on 1 hectare. So I think that we should need to move away from this dichotomy between production and nature, and we really need to start seeing those things together. In terms of the CPD, so this is...
We've actually got a question a little bit further on CPD that we'll probably come back to that and discuss it more widely. I'm going to move to a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. And my question is around the code, which we've kind of touched on already a little bit. So we heard from David, you talked about what's the code for, what's the legal basis, and Lorna, you were talking about that it should be prepared with stakeholders. But I think we would be interested to hear what your thoughts are on what should be in the code, and in a way we've been talking around that. And for example, we heard from both Kirsty and Professor Cathy Dwyer around the need for animal welfare considerations in the objectives, but do we need that in the code? And Ross, you mentioned guidance on organics. So just be interested to hear what you think should be in the code. And also Section 7 on guidance has a part about guidance being created, including the code, and how ministers should be using that. So just anyone's thoughts about that?
Nigel.
Yeah, I suppose my vision of the code is that it's more like a manual. And I think, Vera's probably been involved in assessing various techniques and evaluating them. And I think that some of her work is, I suppose, quite pivotal to how we actually progress agriculture in a sustainable, low-carbon methodology. But to me, we don't want to micromanage. What we want to do is to get information to farmers to actually list the interventions or techniques you can use, define their value and impact on the environment and biodiversity in the soil. And also, to me, you need to define whether they have any direct or indirect impact on the climate change inventory. And that then gives people a very... a really powerful manual as to some of the techniques that they may think of drawing down or they may already be using on their holding. And to me, we don't want to micromanage, but I think there are fundamental principles, although it's been seen to cost money by some analysis and economists. I think that probably it should be pretty well mandatory that if you're cropping, you do have a rotation and there's some nutrient building phase within that rotation. And I think that if you're putting down swards, unless you get some sort of derogation, you should be putting in clovers and having a mixed sward. Those two, I think, we've just got to take, and it's a cost. And presumably the actual clovers won't be a cost if you manage them right. There will be and if you look at the data, there's a positive to that. So it's a manual, but it's got to have those actual outcomes in it so that people can assess their value in implementing them.
Okay, I've got Cathy, Kirsty, and then Dave.
Thank you. To come back on the animal welfare point, and I agree with what Nigel said, you don't
it's not about micromanaging, it's about giving guidance. And I think we do already have codes for the welfare of the farmed species, so recommend linking to those. But I think I just wanted to comment that there are also other animals on farm that aren't the production animals. There's the wildlife, the other animals that exist on the farm as well. And I think, and they also have a welfare state. They're not protected in the same ways, but nonetheless, from a, I think Kirsty already mentioned, a sort of more progressive view of animal welfare would consider that the wildlife on it still have value. We've talked about biodiversity and nature value. So I think something that recognises the welfare state of those animals, that they, as well as the production animals. So I think having something that's sort of, I guess in a manual, that providing that sort of underpinning understanding that these animals have a value in their own right, and that most citizens, no, not just the consumers, citizens have an interest in the protection of those animals as well.
Can I just ask, is it covered in another
Rachel, I've got about six people with their hands up. What I'm going to do, I'm going to take Kirsty and Dave, then I'm going to bring in Jim Fairley, and I can bring you in after that, Rachel. Kirsty.
Yes, I just wanted to respond directly to the question from Ariane Burgess. Yes, we do believe that animal welfare should be explicitly stated as a key outcome objective of the bill, and it should also be explicitly in the Code of Practice for Sustainable and Regenerative Agriculture. I also just wanted to, I was reflecting on some of the other recent contributions, and I feel like too often animal welfare is, or improving animal welfare is seen as coming at a cost to somebody. So it's a cost to farmers, for example, or a cost to people struggling with the cost of living crisis. And I think we need to try and move away from that zero-sum type of thinking. And we need to, where there seems to be that perhaps conflict, it points to me to a need for more transformational change in our farming and food systems. I think this bill should, there should be much more explicit interaction between this bill and the Good Food Nation Act and the National Food Plan, and where that transformational change is needed, that the two bills really need to work together a lot more. Where we're saying that you know, there need to be improvements in animal welfare, absolutely that needs to be a just transition, and that's not something that should be seen as putting additional pressure or barriers for farmers. It's something that the system needs to change in order to bring forward benefits for the animals and farmers and communities. And that's why I think the interactions with Good Food Nation are really important, because a lot of the discussion around Good Food Nation were, for example, around shorter supply chains, more localised foods. And that would mean that, for example, farmers moving to higher welfare systems could be given a reliable market via public procurement or local food hubs, so that it takes away what might be a perceived risk to making those improvements for animal welfare. And I think the links between the welfare of humans and other animals and the natural world are very well recognised now. The One Health and One Welfare conceptual frameworks are recognised at UN level. And I think we need to be thinking much more in that way about animal welfare. And it should be seen as an investment, not a cost.
Thank you. David Mackay.
Yes, just to respond to Ariane Burgess's question around the code, I think the answer is it depends what you're going to use it for. So our view is that, you know, farmers are already subject to GAIC and SMR requirements for basic payments. We think that the code would be most effective if it was essentially an extension of that baseline. So if Scottish Government can set out what it thinks the kind of universal requirement should be for sustainable and regenerative farming, then that should be at that tier one level, and that can be phased in if need be over time to bring everybody up to that level. And I think that by doing that, you can take more money out of that tier one payment and really be focusing resource on tier two and the more kind of support focused tiers three and four. You know, we haven't talked about money too much yet, but there is a finite budget, and you know, there's reports in the press for the past week that budget is shrinking, and we don't know what's going to happen after the general election next year in terms of future support for the devolved nations on agriculture. So we're asking this budget to do an awful lot of things, and I think over time we need to be pushing more of that towards, as I say, the tier two, which is really focused on those practices that can reduce emissions and increase biodiversity, but also the really important elements in tier three and four. So what the future iteration of agri-environment schemes might look like, but also things like knowledge exchange. I mean, we're involved with projects with organisations, including Land Workers Alliance at the moment, on peer-to-peer knowledge exchange. And we have found over the years that's a very effective way of farmers learning from one another on best practice. So there needs to be an increase in funding for that type of thing as well. Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Thanks for that. The range of the discussion that we've had already shows the complexity of what it is that we're actually trying to do here. We started off talking about the objectives and planning, the overarching objectives of the agricultural policy for the purposes of the Act, adoption and the use of sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices. What's the definition of that? In the route map that the Scottish Government produced earlier on, part one of that is improving animal welfare, increasing climate resilience of production, carbon, capturing carbon in soils and vegetation, enhancing water quality and supply in the landscape, supporting thriving biodiversity and ecosystems, but we also have to make sure that we're producing high quality food. Nigel just talked about what does the code of practice look like. It has to be a manual that farmers can work to, but how do you do that across the whole country when you've got such a diverse country and there's diversity on individual farms? So I think probably the point I'm trying to push is the fact that this is a framework bill. There is no way that we can have a one-size-fits-all going throughout this bill. It's going to have to be almost regional in its approach. But what the government has done has set out that route map to allow us to get to the point where we are just now, that the framework bill is quite literally the only way that we can develop this to achieve all of the aims of... And this is just one round table. There's going to be other round tables where there's going to be even more demands put on this bill. So are we in the right place with terms of a framework bill, and is it going to have to be done on a regional basis?
Liz.
And can I just add another complexity in that at the moment we're completely excluding fish. And if we're thinking about animal welfare, we're also thinking about good food production. And with the increase in closed-loop systems as well, that I think fish are going to have to come into this as well.
Okay, look, I'm going to push you on that. How does the Agricultural and Rural Communities Reform Bill include fish?
So, Donald was talking earlier about the use of seaweed as well, as we're using that in certain types of farming. So you've got also the increase in systems now which are going to be used more on land. It's a form of high-quality protein that's being produced. It's going to overlap into
I'm sorry to be rude. I don't think this is actually within the scope of the bill that's in front of us. I think we need to be really conscious that today's about looking at the bill that's in front of us and what's in it, what's not in it, what should be in it, and what should come after it. I don't think aquaculture at the moment is going to form part of that. I know we've got rural communities, but I don't think we're at the stage of looking at that just now.
That's fine. That's fine. Raise it. Thank you.
On Jim's question... Nigel.
When I suggested that it should be a manual, I was suggesting that there would only be two mandatory requirements, one on arable production or crop production and one on establishing grassland. And the rest of the manual would be, give you information and you could draw down on a menu what you thought was appropriate for your farm to actually allow different regions and different systems to actually tailor the regenerative approach to their actual situation.
Okay. So, can I just add into that as a question? We've already got these monitor farms where farmers are going and working together collectively in one area. Do you see that as a vital tool going forward in order to achieve the collective aims that the bill is trying to establish?
I think it could spotlight what is effective and trial new approaches and foster innovation. I think that would be quite helpful, yes.
Tara.
I think it's worth saying when we're talking about a bit about this question, but also the kind of just what should be in the code generally, that I think we shouldn't forget that we do have examples across all sectors and all regions of Scotland of really amazing regenerative sustainable farming where people are sequestering carbon, they are improving biodiversity, it's actively working for nature, and they're producing local food. So these examples exist, and that the farmers who are already doing that, who are way ahead of the curve, have a very good sense of the practices that they're using and what counts as regenerative and sustainable. They will look different in different areas. They'll look different in farms in the same area that are doing different approaches. And I think that any kind of practice, any kind of manual does really need to be co-designed with the farmers who are already doing those things. I think the Monitor Farm Programme is amazing. I think it's great. But I think that doesn't represent the farmers who are at the most ahead of the curve in terms of innovation on sustainable and regenerative farming. And so convening the farmers who really are the furthest ahead with that, I think, is very important for developing what exactly should be in the code of practice. I agree, I think it needs to be quite a bit of a manual and fairly broad. I think that we could expand on some of the specifics of what could be in it. For example, I think something like reducing pesticide use or reducing inputs generally does seem kind of crucial to regenerative and sustainable farming, and it's still fairly broad in terms of how you would go about doing that. But I think there are more specifics that we can include. But yeah, it should be co-designed with the people who are already doing that.
Okay, was it Ross and then Vera?
Just a quick one on a more general point. I mean, one of the key things, I mean, all these things are linked to climate change, biodiversity, animal welfare, a reduction of antibiotic use, but also the knowledge transfer side of it's really important. You know, we need to do that. And the KTIF funding is hugely welcome in that respect. Yeah.
Okay, Vera.
I completely agree that the code should be very flexible, manual, with some prescribed things. But because of the flexibility and the complexity, we have to improve the monitoring aspect, which Ross mentioned quite early on, at the farm level, for the outcomes we want to achieve at the national level, because we have very little time to achieve our targets. And if we just try to go into that direction, but we are not monitoring on the farms, and then eventually don't tie the payments for the outcomes and the results on the farm, then we are going to miss our targets.
Okay, thank you. And we move to a question from Kate Forbes.
Thank you very much. Well, we've spent quite a lot of time on one of the objectives in terms of regenerative agriculture and sort of strayed into some of the others. And I have a series of questions which I'll keep quite short because I might not get back in. So my question, first of all, is that in today's evidence and also in the evidence that many of you provided in advance, there was a temptation, and I've heard it already, to try and get more objectives than we can count in the bill, because all of these things are laudable and important, but it defeats the whole point of a targeted bill. So we've got four objectives in front of us. Do you think that four is the right number, or would you be happy with 10, 15, 20? So this is a question about numbers, not a question about additional objectives. And then secondly, specifically on the fourth objective, which actually reflects the title of the bill, around enabling communities to thrive, rural communities to thrive, sorry. What does that look like to you? And is that sufficiently prescriptive? And do you see it being in tension with any of the other objectives? Now, having just said, don't put too many objectives in, I've just asked you too many questions.
Donald?
Thanks, Muir. I think on the number, I think this is a, it is a difficult question, this, because I don't think we should be saying we can only have four if there's another one that could come in that makes sense. I think there is some logic in making it focused and trying not to get too carried away. But as I said in my earlier contribution, I do think that there is room for some more specific objectives there around small scale and, like I said, about protecting incomes. But I appreciate that everybody will want to chip in with other outcomes to add to that, other objectives to add to that too, and that you could end up with a sort of rambling list of lots of different things that it perhaps doesn't quite deliver. I think on the second part of the question on rural communities, I don't necessarily see it in tension with the other objectives, but I see agricultural support and everything that this policy is trying to deliver as being absolutely key to the success and viability of many of our rural communities, and I think sometimes that that connection can be overlooked. So I'm actually really pleased to see that as one of the objectives on the face of the bill, and making that link between agricultural support and how our rural communities thrive and function. But I think we also need to be considerate. We've talked a bit about where this sits in relation to the common agricultural policy, and I think we do need to reflect on and be aware of where this bill sits now in relation to things that the CAP did in the past. So particularly things like community-led local development, which seem to be being developed in other areas of policy now. But making sure that these important things that drove rural development in much of our areas, that these are still being catered for, and that but maintaining that link with agriculture as well, that these things are connected and they don't happen in isolation. Thanks.
Thank you.
Can I push Donald on that, just really briefly?
Yes, certainly.
You said that you don't see the tension there. Is there not a concern from a crofting perspective that there might be a tension between a rural crofting community thriving and what might be required with the other objectives? It's just, I mean, you have already said you don't see a tension. I just wanted to ensure that is really what you...
Yeah. I mean, I think depending on the direction that the policy heads in on the back of some of these objectives, then there is the chance for that to emerge, and it's one of the things that I think we've been very strong in calling for cognizance of what crofting needs, I think, to be able to continue to thrive. And one of those which I haven't touched on yet, which I'll bring in here, is actually around payment system and around redistribution of payments, which is another thing which we think is very important for how those businesses actually continue to be supported. It's also a link back to alignment with the EU. It's something that's being brought in with the latest version of the CAP. And I think moving money around is one of these areas where I think tensions do develop and can develop, and that we need to make sure that that Scottish agriculture as a whole is able to thrive and function. But in doing so, we need to acknowledge that some areas have probably been under-supported or have definitely been under-supported, and moving that support actually to some of these under-supported areas, which I would argue would be crofting and our marginal areas, who have not benefited as much from the current three region system. So I think there is definitely some areas where there could be conflict emerging there. But I hope that in recognising the importance of what crofting can deliver here, that if we're able to introduce other objectives that relate specifically to those small producers, then we can mitigate against that.
Thanks.
Thank you. Tara.
On the first point about the number of objectives, I think we need more than four. I do think it's important that it's a targeted and direct kind of objectives, but that the rest of the bill leaves so much room for, you know, it's giving powers to ministers to make decisions, and what those decisions look like and where they go, it basically is completely not directed at all by anything in the bill other than these objectives. And so having just four that leave out quite a lot of really what seem to me very crucial areas, like the fact that it doesn't talk about farmers and their well-being and their livelihoods at all in the objectives, to me these things are essential, that they are in the objectives, so that ministers have to take that into account when they make the decisions later on. So I think a more thorough list of objectives is really crucial in a framework bill. I don't think there should be 15, but I think 10 wouldn't be unreasonable. In terms of the... Yeah, and I really support what Donald's been saying about an objective around small scale and crofting, and how having something like that can really make sure that decisions made under other aspects of the legislation don't negatively impact on those communities. Like, we do need that in place, like, very clearly in the framework. In terms of the thriving rural communities objective, I think it's really important that that's there. I think it's worth noting that the bill is the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill, but very much most of the legislation discusses agricultural payments, with less looking at the rural community side of it. And I think that that's something to consider as to how, you know, a broader idea of what thriving rural communities looks like could come under this framework legislation. But I think there's some of the objectives that are necessary for the rural communities. Things like looking at fair farmers' incomes, improving the position of farmers in supply chains, those things are crucial for thriving rural communities. And it's less that the rural communities objective is in tension with the other objectives, and more that it feels very in tension with the actual proposed plan of the payment system. So the proposed plan of the payment system is that the majority of the money will be an area-based payment, currently with no mandatory redistribution. So the most money will go to the biggest businesses, the biggest landowners. At the moment, that's a huge proportion of the budget is going to big businesses, basically. While sort of medium scale and family farms are really squeezed, small scale receives almost nothing, crofting receives almost nothing. And that is not supporting thriving rural communities. So I think any kind of sense that that's the main system that we're going to move forward with, is really in tension with that objective. And that really needs to be, so I think it's a crucial objective from that perspective. And I would really echo what Donald was saying about the importance of introducing a redistributive payment system, a mandatory redistributive payment system in the primary legislation, which is now under the primary legislation of the CAP, so it's in place across all of Europe, and has been shown to be beneficial in supporting a wider rate, more farmers, diversity of farmers. And that redistributive payment would really help to meet that thriving rural communities objective.
OK, I've got everybody wants to come in the back of this. So I've got Nigel, Cathy, and then David. And then we'll reassess.
I think it's fairly clear that more than four is would be helpful. And there's been comments about what they should be. I suspect that early on the CAP was held up as a reasonable model. And to me, the clarity of those objectives and the number of objectives looks fairly helpful, and it maybe to me would be more helpful than the four we have. As far as the actual legislation is concerned, it's enabling, and I think there's, people have talked about the scope of how you actually spend the budget and how you should redistribute it if you want to maintain rural communities. And I think that is, there for the, for the next process to do that as is best. But I think you want to remember about all rural communities and the fact that, Dumfries and Galloway has more than 10 or 11% of the economy, as it's actually based on agriculture, and the Borders, where I come from, is about 8%, and Orkney's 11 or something, is it, or 12, so it's the most extreme. So don't forget about these areas when you think about redistributing money. I suppose I spent my early life working in the crofting communities in Sutherland and Caithness, and so I have quite a passion for it. But I think it is absolutely fundamental that the crofting framework is actually maintained and supported in such a way that it actually, I suppose, creates a baseline of activity within these areas and a community that actually works. There's obviously infrastructural problems there that we need investment. But I think that also, we've talked about biodiversity and sequestration and how that might fit in. And, it was taken that I talked about two strands, there'd be one type that won't do one another. In reality, everybody's going to have to do something. And everybody's probably going to have 10% of their land contributed to biodiversity or sequestration. But there should be in Tier 2 options to look at wider, maybe commitments to sequestration and biodiversity, and the crofting areas would be, you know, could maintain their production and their activity, but also get funding to actually contribute to those goals. They've got the land types and the ecosystems and the habitats which actually could fit into that type of farming and get additional payments. And that actually moves us towards our national goals. And all of these visionary sort of requirements which we're mapping out here have to be seen in the context. We've got to reduce emissions, we've got to increase sequestration and biodiversity on our farmland, and also produce food. And that shouldn't be forgotten when we look at all the, you know, the detail of the nice-to-have options that we require.
Thank you. Cathy, and then David.
Thank you. I guess I'm reiterating, so I'll keep it short, reiterating the point that four probably is too few. They're too, I mean, they are overarching, so maybe having some sub-objectives is underneath it, but at the moment there's a lack of clarity, I suppose, for people to understand exactly what falls underneath this and how this is going to progress in the future. And again, I guess I would just come back and say I think improving animal health and welfare is in the CAP. As has been mentioned already, it's something that's supported by the British Veterinary Association and a number of other areas as well, that this is something that's not a nice to have. I think this is fundamental to having high quality food, sustainable agriculture, having thriving rural community. It does sit underneath all of these, but I think it needs that addition of being a specific objective to ensure that there is actual progress in this area.
You've got David, then Liz and Kirsty.
I won't reiterate what's already been said about the numbers, but I agree with what the previous contributions have made. I just want to make a point on enabling rural communities to thrive. I think that the bill, as it's drafted, is quite strong on agricultural support, but arguably less so on wider rural development. I think that in the first instance, it is absolutely imperative that we can have profitable and resilient rural businesses, and that I think that should not be in conflict with a switch to nature-friendly farming. In fact, there's reports from Nature-Friendly Farming Network that have pointed out the cost savings to be made from moving to these approaches. So that's the first thing, but we shouldn't forget about the wider rural development and some of the other evidence responses that I looked at before coming today. One example that was flagged was LEADER funding. So there's lots of things that were previously happening that we have to make sure that the bill, which I think possibly could be strengthened in this area, is also delivering on that wider rural development piece.
Thank you. Just to reassure you, I've got everybody's name down. So I've got Liz, Kirsty, Vera, Ross and Lorna in that order. So we'll go to Liz next.
Thank you. Yes, I think maybe not enough, but also there's a gap perhaps between the production of the high quality food and then where that's going. Because obviously the networks and how that then gets out to the consumer is what's going to help the rural communities to thrive. So I do think there's potentially a gap there. And also I know there's tension between bringing about change now and what that's going to look like in the future, particularly with the very long timelines that we work on in agriculture. But those crops are going to change. And I think there has to be some flexibility around what's being produced as well. Sometimes the priority will be food, other times in another area it might be feedstocks with plastic alternatives, cellulose, etc. So that was also just something to consider.
Thank you. Kirsty and then Vera.
Thanks. I'll try and be brief just to respond to the two different parts of Kate Forbes' question. I agree. I don't think there's a problem with having more than four objectives. And I do think that animal welfare is important and it should be a standalone objective. If for some reason Scottish Government and Parliament were not minded to do that, I think it should be made much more explicit that animal welfare, continuous improvement in animal welfare, should be seen as a core component of both high quality food production and sustainable and regenerative agriculture. The second part of the question was about, are there any tensions with thriving rural communities? And I guess I just wanted to build on what I'd already said. No, there shouldn't be. I mean, the well-being of humans and other animals is inextricably linked. And I've heard reports from farmers who have made improvements for their animal welfare, and it has subsequently made their own job satisfaction you know, higher because they care about their animals, of course. I want to go back. Earlier I was talking about the welfare concerns for broilers, and just to say that, you know, those intensive chicken farms also cause a lot of environmental damage. I think we're seeing a lot of reports in the media recently down south about the River Wye and the pollution from chicken farms. And there have also been situations in Scottish communities where the communities have really pushed back against those kind of intensive units in their community. So that's just an example that about the well-being of people and communities and animals being linked. I am using a poultry example purposefully because I know that that's sort of outside of the current subsidy scheme. And I'm going back to what I was saying previously about the fact that the agricultural policies and the Good Food Nation policies should be working together more to drive up standards and bring food system changes across the board. So we want to make sure that the welfare of all animals is considered, not only those who currently receive subsidies. And that's a good example of that.
Thank you, Kirsty. Vera and then Ross.
Thank you. I feel that regarding rural communities, the bill can do many things, but I still feel it is quite restrictive in its current form because it's so much linked to food production and not so much to wider ecosystem service generation, which will have to happen in large scale very soon. So farmers might decide to provide more sequestration other services or not to grow any crops anymore, and then will they fall out of under the bill, or what will be their support, and what is the support for the communities where larger scale sequestration, peatland restoration and other things will happen. So the bill, I don't feel the bill really covers all of the land use, and it should link with all these objectives. Also, regarding changes in farm, we can reduce our greenhouse gas emissions by 10-15% by the changing of the systems. We can do probably another 10% by reducing food waste, what brings us really to our target, minus 30% or 40%, is reducing the consumption of high land use, high greenhouse gas products, which is mostly livestock, red meat, ruminants. Now, that ties with land use change, and it's not really clear the pathway for those farmers, what will happen to them, how they can change, how they can transform in a just way. And what it also links with is what Kirsty was saying, the link with Good Food Nation. The Good Food Nation is, in my opinion, very weak in terms of supporting this transition in our food consumption and diets. And because it's so that needs to change, and also the links between this bill in reducing the production of high greenhouse gas intensity food products needs to link with the reducing the consumption of high greenhouse gas intensity food products.
Thank you. I'm going to go to Ross and then Lorna.
Just one thing to say that nobody's spoken about, and that's land reform. Land needs to be made available, more readily available, if you want to enable communities to thrive. And one of the things we discussed when the meetings were going around the country talking about this, somebody said it should be made law that any farm for sale comes onto the open market for a limited period of time so that people can see it and get a chance to bid for it, rather than large farms getting sold round the kitchen table by agreement between two farmers that never even sees the market. Because the concentration of land ownership, it hasn't got any better in Scotland, really, in a way, and especially in our area, where a lot of the big dairy farms are getting bigger and bigger, and when a farm comes in the market, it gets gobbled up without so much of a chance. People aren't looking for a giveaway, they're looking for a chance just to bid for it, or a group of people to bid for it. And as Tara says, a lot of these people could do a hell of a lot with a very small area of land. So,
thank you. Warner.
It's more a picky comment, but it's about the production of high quality food, and that terminology is hazy. What is high quality food? Is it the nutritional value of the food? Is it the wider public goods that have accompanied production? And I also think, and this goes back to Nigel's point, we should also mention in some way food quantity. And I fully believe we need to safeguard Scotland's food production. We need to make Scotland as self-sufficient as possible. So I think there'll be a squeeze as climate change impacts and as areas of production are impact, the price of food will go up, firstly. But also, if we reduce production, that production will be met elsewhere. And that could result in, it will result in us simply offshoring emissions and biodiversity loss. And that could happen in countries that don't have the same environmental regulation as we do. So personally, I don't feel it's right to remove the quantity of food as well from the bill.
OK. Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. A few people have touched on the difficulties that the farmers have in transforming what they do for want of information about support they might receive or the adequacy thereof. I just wonder, do people also have a view about the other bit of that, which is that beyond 2025, the Scottish Government has, or Scottish farmers, more importantly, have no idea what the funding envelope is from the UK and how that impacts on farmers' thinking and decision-making?
Nigel?
I think, clearly it does. I mean, I think, that sort of black hole which seems to be sort of growing in budgets, throughout the UK, and the attitude of the Westminster Government towards agriculture and certainly domestic food production, does actually erode confidence and is part of the reason why a lot of producers probably feel powerless and are not optimistic about the future. If that can be resolved, it'd be really helpful. And I think it is worth remembering, A, that inflation has eroded 30% of the budget's value as it is. And if you look at what we want to achieve, which some of it is fairly specific on things like animal welfare and soil qualities and that, but it's all about sustainable systems and biodiversity right from the soil to the apex predators, actually building that. These actually add further management challenges and further costs to production systems. Therefore, if you want these diverse outputs and public goods, the actual budget should be rising, not falling. So I think that's the other message that I think should be loud and clear.
Any other comments? I'm going to suspend the meeting until 10:50 for a comfort break. Okay, we'll get started again. We're going to move on with a question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to see what the views are of our roundtable today on the Rural Support Plan. A note that from some written statements and evidence that some have commented about the detail that might be in here, but also what they may think that ministers should have a regard to. I know, Ross, you mentioned perhaps land reform, for example. So I'd just like to kick that off, Convener, if I may.
Nigel.
On a technical point, really, I suppose, adding to what Ross said, is that, you know, probably, you know, this bill or the secondary legislation has got to redefine what agriculture is. And the reality is, at the moment, it's quite restrictive, and that impacts on tenants. And your tenants have also got to be, or you've got to classify your woodland management or habitat management or sequestration as agricultural activities, so that tenants actually don't fall foul of their landlord by taking part in these initiatives. So I think that's quite important. But I think the other thing, which is probably quite important, which is very techie, is ineligible land. The EU's defined what ineligible land is, and some of it is roads and yards, and that's fair enough, but it also includes woodlands and scrub and winds and scree, wetlands, ponds, hedges. It's all ineligible. That definition has got to change so that those are brought into the system and are actually recognised for their biodiversity and their sequestration value. And that requires a change of definition of eligible land, but it also requires mapping. And, you know, the mapping we have is all on eligible land, and even, you know, hedges that have actually been paid for by the Scottish Government, they aren't bloody mapped on the Scottish system, a lot of them. So, you know, there's real gaps in our mapping system. We don't really know, or government doesn't have good mapping of where biodiversity is on farmland. So there's some major sort of rather techie sort of changes that this Enabling Act has got to facilitate change on.
Anyone else like coming to say it? Tara, beg your pardon.
I'd actually like to come in on the land reform point to bring that back up again. I do think it's really important that our rural support plan and agricultural payment system has regard for land reform, because one of the key objectives of the land reform legislation is reducing concentration of land ownership, and yet the proposed rural support plan actively incentivises through an area-based payment that basically the hoarding of land. So those pieces of legislation feel in kind of direct opposition to each other. So I think it is very important that overall aim of the land reform legislation is taken into regard when developing a rural support plan. I think it's also crucial, just because, you know, we're looking at a really sort of ageing population of farmers. It's very difficult for new entrants, it's very difficult for young farmers to properly get into the farming sector. Certainly we have loads of members who are well trained, really keen, just want to farm and can't access land. So I do think we need to start taking seriously that issue of new entrants, and that tying in with land reform is a crucial way to do that in the rural support plan.
Thank you. Dave.
Yeah, thank you. Yes. Firstly, just to agree with what Nigel said around definitions and ineligible land, I would strongly agree with that. The point I wanted to make from our point of view, we think the rural support plan essentially should be a mechanism for a government to set out how it is going to use public money to deliver on the objectives stated in the legislation. And I think in order to do that, there needs to be a mechanism within that plan for monitoring and evaluation. And I think that's something that's currently missing from the bill as drafted. I think that should be both in terms of the objectives I've set out in the bill, but also to make sure we're getting value for public money. And I think there's an opportunity for this committee actually to push a little bit on this and suggest to the government that the first iteration of that rural support plan should be brought forward at the earliest opportunity. And I think before the secondary legislation starts to come in, essentially, because we cannot be making decisions on secondary legislation if we don't know what's going to be in this five-year plan. And just very quickly, in terms of what else it might align to, the Scottish Government has a commitment to produce an organic action plan, and work is about to start on that next year. I think that part of that rural support plan should include, or be at least linked to, what the organic action plan is trying to do in terms of developing that sector.
Dave, I'm absolutely delighted that you suggested the committee take that role, because that's something that was discussed last week, whether the rural plan, given its importance, whether this Parliament should have a role in scrutinising that and ensuring that the detail of that was adequate to deliver what the vision of the government was. So thank you for that, because that was my next question. Anybody else want to come in on that?
Can I just come in on the importance of being able to plan for a bit longer? There are a lot of bodies, a lot of organisations who are doing work in this area whose funding is year to year, if that, and you end up losing a lot of skills because of that. So the ability to be able to plan longer and to be able to support groups who are working within that sector over a longer time period would be really useful.
Karen.
Come back on that. Could you give a specific time frame? How long do you think is long enough for that planning?
Well, with a forestry background, the quinquennia, your five-year block of time, is I think, useful for the kind of projects that we're talking about. The actual aims and objectives have to be much further, obviously, much longer term. But the five-year block would be very useful.
Okay. So on that basis, are you suggesting we should have a rural support plan, a short term and a medium term and a long term should form basis of that? Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Rachel Hamilton.
Well, let's just carry on the rural support plan. I know that the Scottish Crofting Federation had, in their submission, talked about some of the related matters that should be included in the RSP. I just wondered if others would like to put on record what they believe should be in the plan in terms of those related matters that cross-reference other bills or acts.
Anyone want to come in on that? Lorna, I appreciate your time's limited. Would you like to come in just now?
Sorry, on interactions with other policy areas. I think, looking at the biodiversity strategy, a lot of these policy areas are separate, and that they should be better integrated. Also, I think we need to consider what a good farm looks like and what we want that vision to be. And as Jim said, that depends on the location, it depends on the system, but also we need to look at what's happened in the past. In the past, farmers were tasked with producing food. We delivered this. It came at an expense. And now many farmers feel blamed for this. So you have this unrest, perhaps. And if we look at future and current policy, farmers are going to have to navigate a huge number of challenges. And I would say I don't know any other small business that has to remain economically viable whilst dealing with pests, diseases, protecting the environment, feeding the nation, local and global market fluctuations, changes in regulations and policy, and to do this under increasingly difficult weather conditions. And I think we need to recognise this pressure and the high incident of mental health concerns in the farming community. I would say all farmers see themselves as stewards of the land. Farmers do want to leave their land in a better place. And I think farmers are ready for the change. They need the support mechanisms to allow them to make change whilst being economically viable.
Thank you. I've got Donald, Tara and then Kirsty.
Thank you, Convener. Rachel Hamilton mentioned our submission there, and just wanted to come in on the point that we were trying to make. And I think it's important that the rural, or there's an opportunity, I think, in the rural support plan to make sure that we are looking at the crossovers between different policy areas here. I think we've all identified, and it's been mentioned in this discussion about the problems that could emerge from thinking in silos and different policy areas that will be impacted by agricultural policy and will impact agricultural policy themselves. So we were talking about specifically about crofting law reform as well, that it's important that we acknowledge what's happening there and make sure that these things are compatible. So for us, that's things like looking at common grazings and how they interact. So there's no point having an agricultural policy that doesn't acknowledge how crofting works in a regulatory context. Also important to look at the work that's going on around the Good Food Nation Act, and what's also been mentioned already about the Land Reform Bill, and that we're acknowledging the impact that this bill will have on those other policy areas. So thanks.
Thank you. Tara.
I just wanted to come in specifically on the Good Food Nation Act and the national food plans, and I suppose the regional food plans as well. I feel like this is an area which really needs to be linked closely with the rural support plan, because the rural support plan is obviously crucial for how we deliver on some of the things that we're going to see in the national food plan, in terms of local food, developing local food systems, reducing our imports, being more self-sufficient, all of those kind of things will need to be delivered through the rural support plan. So I think that there needs to be much closer connection between the legislation on food and the legislation on agriculture. They can't really be separated in the way that they currently are, and they need to take each other into account quite significantly. Just looking at climate and nature when planning a rural support plan could risks really deviating from the kind of objectives of the national food plans.
Convener, before you bring the next witness in, one of the areas that would be under consideration, I've noticed that actually some individuals have connected working with organic farming and actually gene editing, and I wondered if a specific gene editing bill as well would benefit some of the climate change mitigations that we're trying to enact, and if anyone had an opinion on that as well, if they so wished.
It may just be out with the scope of what we can do here, but does anybody have any comments on potential interactions between the bill and future bills relating to gene editing? Nigel?
Yeah. I mean, I think that this is a really controversial subject, which is going to maybe cause a car crash and just stop anything happening. But I mean, the reality is, if you look at gene editing logically, it's actually achieving what you could achieve by selective breeding, but actually doing it in a very fast and precise way. And we've obviously used selective breeding, I think the Short Shorn Society is at 220 years old or something, for a long time, and we've selectively bred, and probably inbred to a degree in some of these breeds. To me, it is actually a solution to some disease pressures, and if we want to get rid of or reduce pesticide use, that makes perfect sense in crops. And if we look back in history at that sort of iconic sort of spring barley for malting, Golden Promise, it was actually a product of irradiating seed. So we haven't actually always had a very clean biological way of creating our varieties. So to me, it looks like an important tool. And if you look at this in mitigation measures, there are, genetic improvement and also the ability to use nitrogen more efficiently in plants is really key to actually, reducing inputs, but also reducing emissions. So these are quite important areas that we should be looking at.
Thank you. Kirsty.
Thanks. I think it's very important that the rural support drives up animal welfare standards across the board. I was asked earlier in the session about, concerns, and I spoke about broiler chickens, but I just wanted to reiterate that there are quite serious animal welfare concerns across species. We have laying hens who have calcium constantly depleted from their bones, so there's a high level of fractures. We have pigs in farrowing crates for 5 weeks at a time, so they can't turn around. So I think although our animal welfare standards are some of the highest in the world, they're not high enough, and we need to see continuous improvement, and that requires system change. So to be more specific, for example, rural support could support pig farmers with infrastructure changes to move away from farrowing crates. It could support the provision of small local abattoirs. I would agree with Tara that there does need to be much more interaction with Good Food Nation. And as I mentioned earlier, that could involve public procurement as a way of providing a reliable market for farmers who move to higher welfare systems. I also wanted to recognise what Lorna said about farmers' mental health and the pressures on them, and just reiterate that we're talking about systems change here. Kate Rowell from Quality Meat Scotland gave evidence to this committee months ago now, and she spoke really passionately about her family farm and the farmers' desires to do the right thing. And she pointed out that, and I'll quote here, she said, "All we've been doing over the generations is following policy signals." And I think that's the point, is that we need to change the policy signals to allow animal welfare to be improved and allow the system change that is required for that.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Liz mentioned there about the benefits in terms of sending policy signals around some of these, a phrase that was used in the last contribution, around some of these issues, whether 5-year funding for agriculture. I appreciate, Convener, you may not like me making this point, but obviously the Scottish Parliament doesn't know from month to month essentially what its income will be next year, never mind in 5 years, not only in agriculture but on anything else. So I just wonder, Convener, you know, given some of what we've heard today, would it be worth another try getting a UK agriculture minister to come and explain some of this, given that the last one told us he was unavailable indefinitely?
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Alistair. We have written. I don't think this is particularly the time to raise that, because we're opening up. Well, we should maybe have the Cabinet Secretary for Agriculture coming in here and explaining why 10% of the agriculture budget, which was ring-fenced, was removed. But we're not going to go there. But we have written to the UK Minister, as you're well aware. I'll now move on to questions from Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. And could I turn people's attention to Schedule 1, which kind of lays out an awful lot of the detail of this. And I wonder whether people believe it provides the support and the purposes that is required for a replacement to CAP, and indeed a new agricultural policy for us, and whether it meets people's aspirations for the new policy.
Who'd like to kick off? No one going to have a go?
I'm not asking everyone to read Schedule 1, but it basically highlights all the things that could have support through the bill.
Yeah. So, sorry, Vera.
Oh, thank you. I've read it through quite detailed level, and while I feel it tries to cover many things, being prescriptive will always risk missing a few things. And I would come back to Liz's point about aquaculture. Aquaculture is also food production, and that's one thing. But there are quite a few other things which are not listed and still related to food production and ecosystem services. So I think it needs to be a little bit reiterated. Schedule 1.
OK. Nigel and then Tara.
Yeah, I suppose these are fairly technical issues, but it wasn't clear looking at Schedule 1 whether some of these issues were going to be covered. And I've talked about the classification of ineligible land and the upgrading of mapping, but I think there's also obligations for under the next agricultural bill to have some sort of oversight of carbon calculators and their standards to ensure that they actually reflect science and they actually fit with the inventory and ensure that people use only approved calculators. And in reality, these are going to be important management tools, but they may also be audit tools in the future as well. And at the moment, we don't have that. And we also have commercial pressures from retailers and processors who want to actually show green credentials, asking producers, their producer group, to do particular things, and sometimes be audited by a different type of calculator which doesn't actually reflect some of the standards that I've talked about. So I think that's quite urgent, and I think to actually back that up, there needs to be manuals, not just for regenerative farming techniques, but also for mitigation measures. And there's also got to be an obligation from a government to producers to validate mitigation measures and quantify them, and if necessary, try and, through international means, get them inserted into the inventory. Because at the moment, we've got all sorts of tools out there, some of them feed additives, some genetic techniques, which are going to be quite important, which farmers are taking up. They're told they're going to actually deliver them certain emission benefits, and they're not accepted, or they don't go in the inventory, so it makes no difference, and it's costing them money. That is an irresponsible position to be in, which only government can actually handle. The other area, which, if we look at emissions from agriculture, is that the methane, which is obviously quite high profile, and nitrous oxide, and maybe there needs to be clarification on what methane targets we've actually got to hit, because we've got an international obligation to reduce it by 30% by 2030. 47% of Scotland's methane is from agriculture. There's another chunk from landfill. Landfill's actually reduced its emissions by 70% in the last 10 years. What has Scotland got? What has Scottish agriculture got to do by 2030? Because we're running out of time. So that clarity is important. But I think the other area is carbon dioxide, which is really, there's some carbon dioxide leakage when you cultivate land, but it's quite small. 90% probably of the carbon dioxide emissions are from energy use and kit on farms. There's got to be a transformation of that kit. There needs to be some form of support to actually change that infrastructure. That capital required is not going to be generated by the profitability of agriculture on small farms or large. And if it's not direct, some sort of grant for upgrading, there should be low interest or 0% loans. That is an easy low-hanging fruit. If you spend the money, you'll get 10% reduction in emissions. And the agriculture is the third biggest emitter in Scotland, so it makes a difference. Spend the money, you'll get that 10% benefit. There's nothing in the bill to actually suggest that's going to happen. And maybe the budgets aren't there for that to happen. So that's something that we've really got to address.
Thank you. I've got Tara, Donald, Ross, and then Liz.
What's included in Schedule 1, and there's a few lists under Schedule 1 of things that can be supported. I think it is, they're pretty comprehensive lists in general, and we welcome that, quite a strong inclusion of fruit and vegetables and nut production, things like that. There's some notable things that are kind of left off the list, like pigs and poultry, like pork and chicken and eggs. Are left off the list of products that support can be offered for. And I understand why that's been the case in the past, but we're talking about some of the sectors that need to transition, need the most work to transition in a Scottish context. So we don't want to be funding unsustainable practice, industrial factory farming of chickens, perhaps. But we do need the support to be in place to help our egg industry, pork industry transition to more sustainable practice. And there are very good examples of what sustainable practice looks like. We have members who keep pigs in woodland, which is amazing for woodland management and produces local food. We have members who are engaged in pastured poultry systems, which is really supporting biodiversity regeneration. There are examples of very transformational practices with pigs and poultry, and there's nothing under the Schedule 1 at the moment that allows this bill to shape the direction of those sectors, and leaving those sectors out removes any pressure on them to change.
Donald.
Thank you. I mentioned earlier on about our suggestion of the introduction of another objective around small producers, and particularly crofting. If that wasn't added as another objective on the face of the bill, I think another place where it could be suitably integrated into the bill would be in Schedule 1. I think it's it's not. It could be more explicit, or it could be a lot more explicit that's something that could be supported. That specific support for smaller producers and for crofters could fit in here quite well. And I think the reason I mention that again is in relation to the question mentioned around how this is a replacement for the cap. And I think we need to look at what's happening in the EU and what's happening in the cap at the moment, and particularly around this area and redistribution, which I've mentioned already. So the regulation there has explicitly made reference to smaller producers and the need to support smaller producers, and that is now driving the policy there, and the outcome of that has been a mandatory redistribution of 10% of the direct support budget to smaller producers. So I think Schedule 1 strikes me as another area of the bill where we could have a more firm commitment to smaller producers and to crofting, and actually have it mandatory that this is looked at and this is implemented. I think it's fair to say that the bill would allow for this to happen, but we much prefer if it went further than that and actually included a commitment to look at redistribution. For all the reasons that we've outlined in our submission, and the disproportionate costs that are associated with that smaller businesses face, but also the benefits that those businesses deliver, which I won't go into now, but we would continue to provide further information on that in the future.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Ross and then Liz.
Just a quick one. One of the things that's been exercising us in the organic group is equivalence across Europe and indeed the UK, because I think David was on a meeting with DEFRA. They're trying to thrash out equivalence because it's going to be a real mess if we've moved too far away from European standards or the UK moves away from European standards to a great extent. Scotland, as I said, so far the government has said it wants to maintain adherence to European standards, but then if it starts to become a real problem, especially when you're trading across the border, which is quite common. So that's something I'd like to be in the mind of the committee too, and I'm sure some of you have thought about it.
Okay, thanks. Liz.
Thank you. I was really pleased to see in Schedule 1 around the ancillary, that's hard to say, activities, including preparing, packaging, but distributing food as well. I thought that was really good to see. It was good to see that also included within forestry, another product derived from a forestry activity, so that's useful to be included as well. It was a little bit concerning, though, the mention around picking wild plants for food. I wasn't sure that necessarily came into the aims of what we were looking at within this. However, the training and education, what I was particularly pleased to see was that learning and sharing information were included together. We have a real challenge within our sector in that knowledge transfer and training have been seen as very separate and had to be kept separate and were funded separately. If we can bring those two together, I think that's going to be really impactful for our sector.
Rhoda?
I maybe ask an even more technical question, sorry. There are powers obviously contained in this part of the bill, and I'm wondering if we need more detail on how those powers are used, but also should we have greater scrutiny on how those powers are used in the new policy? So, for instance, capping of payments, those are new powers. Do we need more detail of how that's used and how it's scrutinised?
Vera and then Tara.
Right, my comment is back to Schedule 1 about the flexibility, emphasising that, also to do with coming climate change and potential change in cropping patterns. If we are listing the current crops, we are missing those which might come in, like miscanthus is not there, and also by not expanding the aims and not aligning with the wider goals, for example, fibre production. Right now, it's a technical issue, but right now, grass production is only included as forage. Grass production can be used in bio-based economies in other ways than feed. So I'm really strongly proposing to make it more flexible, Schedule 1.
Could I ask a quick question on that?
On that one, yes.
What do you mean by grass can be used in other other areas other than forest. Are you talking about biomass?
Yes, biomass in energy AD. So anaerobic digestion, one way of using grass. Another way is to extract the protein and use it as feed or even later on as food. So there are various ways to utilise grass. If we want to have and want to consume as much livestock, we can still keep grass production and utilise the grass in other ways.
Is that sown grass? That has to be from sown grass, not permanent pasture?
Either. I guess if you have it as sown grass, the quality is more regulated or more constant, so probably better for protein production or other extraction methodologies. A non-sown permanent grass might be still good for AD, definitely for anaerobic digestion.
Okay, my slight concern with that is we've had these things happen in the past, particularly in my own constituency, where what that's actually done is take a huge amount of forage out of the marketplace, which has then just pushed up the price for forage for livestock producers that are living in the same area. So there's an opportunity cost for everything that we do, isn't there?
Yes, this is why I emphasised that it has to happen together with consumption changes. Okay. Livestock consumption, diet changes reduced, then you have the forage prices reducing, but you can utilise your grass areas to produce other things than meat and dairy.
Okay, thank you.
Tara.
Yeah, this is back to the point about the powers and whether there should be some kind of, you know, more direction on how those powers are used. I think it was one of the kind of things we emphasised in our submission was that yes, there should be more. The powers granted under this piece of legislation do kind of offer ministers the power to do all the things, the kind of great things we've been talking about, but there's no kind of obligation to do it or even direction in what way to use those powers. And I think that would really strengthen the bill, would be some of that, particularly when we're looking at the points around capping and redistribution, as we've talked about. There's a power to introduce capping, but there's no obligation to do that. There's no direction on how to do that. I think it's really important that something like that does come into the primary legislation. As we have do see in countries in Europe, the kind of giving unlimited public money to people mostly based on area of land is really a misuse of public money, and that should be in the primary legislation. That should be regulated against, basically. So I think some guidance around how to bring in capping, but also to reiterate about the redistributive payments. The legislation talks quite clearly about capping. It doesn't really talk about this. We're saying redistribution. I know that front-loading is also a term used. I think the NFUS tend to use front-loading. We talk about redistribution. It's the same thing. So that's giving more money for the first few hectares of land, and then that either stops, you know, either the amount goes down above a certain threshold or it tapers off. It really supports medium-scale farming, small-scale farming, the people that are, you know, most pushed under the economically at the moment in our farming sector. And that we need some guidance on how to introduce that for ministers. So that should be really laid out in the primary legislation. For example, as in CAP, 10 to 30% of the direct payments budget has to be redistributed to small-scale and new entrant farmers in the EU. Something like that that gives clear guidance and a similar guidance around capping is really important in the primary legislation.
Thank you. Dave, and then...
Yes, very quickly, just on that point on capping, I absolutely agree with Tara and Donald that capping will allow for that redistribution or front-loading, whichever term you want to use, to happen. But I think that the language around that in the bill needs to be tightened up slightly, that we think that capping should only be applicable to direct payments rather than some of the indirect payments, for example, through agri-environment schemes or habitat restoration, etc. I think that would be counterproductive in terms of some of the environmental objectives.
Okay, thank you. Nigel.
Yeah, just to comment on specifically on capping, I mean, I suppose my view would be similar to what's just been articulated as far as, not restricting it to areas with core support. But I think there are, you know, significant dangers in applying it to core support, given the structure of agriculture and the level of employment on some of these larger units, in that what you're actually doing is actually removing the capability to actually pay decent wages and actually create employment, which, you know, is important in many areas. So I think that there are pros and cons for capping that should be looked at. But, you know, to address Rhoda's point, I mean, I think that all these issues should be have clear objective criteria about how they're actually operated, so that it's clear to the public and to farmers, you know, when certain regulations click in, and that it isn't open to controversy or challenge. And I think that's why, probably, if you look at the more complex areas like, you know, what's regenerative farming, you've actually got to keep the definitions, you know, black and white and very simple. And that's why, you know, maintaining your soils within a certain carbon bracket, having a rotation which has a regenerative component in it, and also ensuring that you put clovers into your grass seed mixes or other herbs, is black and white, and you can prove it, you've done it or you haven't done it. And that's really important. There's real stress on farmers on audit and complying. You've got to make it clear what you've got to do, and you've ticked the box. So I think that's quite important. In the last CAP reform, there was an option to have an official advisory service, which wasn't taken up. And I hesitate, you'll bring it up now, you know, this is another cost which the budget maybe can't stand. But the concept is good. If you have the competent authority also delivering an official advisory service, when people are going into system change and totally different approaches to agriculture, you have somebody who is aware of all the criteria they've actually got to deliver on, giving them hands-on advice through that process. And I think that, you know, given that we're probably facing, you know, as big a revolution as we ever have seen in agriculture, you know, that would make perfect sense, and it would actually ensure compliance is built into change rather than waiting for change to happen and then having compliance issues afterwards.
Nobody actually mentioned the scrutiny in this bill as an enabling bill. A lot of the powers of where actually the money's going to come from, and maybe folk would reflect on whether the scrutiny in the bill is enough and maybe right into the committee, because it's maybe not at the forefront of everybody's mind. But if we've got adequate scrutiny within the bill over those powers that really shape the policy going forward. Just very finally, small question. We're obviously looking at alignment with EU CAP, and people are broadly supportive of that, is what I'm picking up. But is there any area that wouldn't be desirable? No.
Ross, you commented on EU alignment. Is there, given the powers that this bill has to create brand new policies?
Yeah, I think for organic standards, I think it's very important we try and maintain EU alignment. Trouble is, if the UK government deviates from that in any great way, it's going to cause all sorts of problems. As far as the rest of the CAP's concerned, I don't think I know enough about it to comment, really.
Okay. Vera.
Comment that there has been quite a debate in Europe about the CAP, especially regarding climate change. It is not going to deliver the greenhouse gas mitigation which is needed in Europe. So while I'm quite pro-alignment, we need to do a lot more on greenhouse gas reduction.
Tara.
Yeah, I would add to that, yeah, I think while alignment with CAP, the CAP is important, and there's some good stuff in that, especially in the newer version of CAP. I know that our legislation is all based on a previous version that hasn't been used for several years now. And there's a lot of updates in the newer CAP legislation that we should be taking into account. So I do think that alignment is important, but I think that, yeah, we need to be more ambitious. We need to be trying to, you know, we talk a lot about being world leading in Scotland. We need to be ahead of the EU, and at the moment we're behind. We need to be pushing forward, and one of the opportunities of writing legislation that's not under CAP is that we can take that as a basis and expand on it, do something better.
Nigel.
I think, you know, Vera touched on, you know, the climate change issues that relate to CAP, but I think it's also biodiversity has been, you know, from the original proposal has been watered down through negotiation. So I think both those areas, you know, probably we have to be more ambitious than that, or we do if we're going to hit our targets anyway.
But you know, it may, at least it's a starting point if you're aligned with CAP, and maybe you can actually build on that through your five-year plan to get to the sort of place which would ensure that we will have some chance of hitting targets. At the moment, we're handicapped because we're probably starting 2 or 3 years too late.
Okay, thank you. I'm supplementing this from Rachel Hamilton.
It's really just about the practicalities of some of the purposes of support in Schedule 1, particularly regarding the agri supply chain. If I start with Donald, it was really around, obviously a lot of people have mentioned the Good Food Nation bill today, but it seems as though the budget that would be associated to what the Good Food Nation Act intends to do will be encompassed into this part of the schedule. And I was wondering, from a practical or behavioural point of view, if crofters will take advantage, for example, of getting together and creating a new abattoir, or looking at the animal haulage service part that they, or the farmers market part that they mention in this, and the same would go to the organic movement as well. It's just, how will this bill, you know, drive those changes? Is it practical?
I think the point that I was making, and the point that we were making in our submission, is around alignment with these things, that we're making sure that we're that the bill is at least aware of what's going on in these other areas of policy. I think you make an important point that how closely linked the Good Food Nation Act and this bill are ultimately going to be. And I think it's important that that support is made available within the framework for the exactly the kind of initiatives that you mentioned there, things like abattoirs and crofters getting together to set up ways of allowing people to have better access to food, which I think is a really important part of it's certainly a very important part of what the Good Food Nation Act was about, and it should be a very important part about what the Agriculture Bill is about as well. So, but making sure that that investment is quite targeted, but acknowledging that, you know, we're going to be dealing with tight budgets here, and making sure that that support is directed in the correct way is going to be absolutely, absolutely critical. But I think it is important that we do see some things in tier, probably fit into your tier four of the policy to be able to support these sorts of initiatives, and certainly something that we would be calling for.
Thanks.
Okay, any further comments on that? Nope. Oh, Nigel, beg your pardon.
Briefly, just coming on abattoirs, because it's something that, you know, has been an issue for, you know, 20 years or more, and certainly I was spent a lot of time on it, including, you know, abattoirs in the islands. And the reality is, you know, there's a capital cost in abattoirs, certainly, even in small abattoirs, but there's also the ongoing costs of skilled labour. And the reality of some of the small abattoirs is that if slaughtermen and those that actually can dress and cut carcasses are only getting 1 day or 2 days' work a week, that makes it quite difficult. And there was actually, looking at rotations about how people could actually move around the islands and around the highlands and islands and do 1 day here and 1 day there. That you know, initially looked as if it had some legs, but the actual lifestyle required for these people was just a nightmare. So if you're going to actually seriously look at, you know, local small abattoirs, you've not only got to look at capital support, you've got to look at ongoing revenue to actually support employment of skilled people within these areas on a part-time basis. Without that, it's not going to go anywhere. And if you look at abattoir, generally, they're not a sexy sector. Nobody loves them, but they're absolutely vital. But if you look at the map of abattoirs in Scotland, you know, even in the major livestock areas, there's an inadequate capacity, and that is only going to get worse because our livestock population is falling quite significantly, and we've seen a consolidation of ownership as well. So and we've obviously, you know, so one of the major abattoirs may well fall out in the next 2 or 3 years. So there's the real issues there. On transport, maybe there's more one can do. And, you know, as somebody who sort of buys livestock in the Highlands and Islands, getting sheep down from Lairg or Thurso or from the Outer Isles is a nightmare because people don't have the number of trucks to actually shift them. And so if we're not going to magic up more trucks, we're not going to magic up the skills that are required to actually operate them, they're big money to actually have these bits of kit. So if you're going to actually facilitate those sort of movements, which are absolutely vital to get these animals out of these high areas, and a lot of them are high-quality stock, you're going to have some sort of supported lairage system to actually hold these sheep, maybe for a week or more, before that transport can actually fit in to actually move it. And that is really urgent. You know, as I say, I think in Thurso there was ewes standing there for, you know, certainly, you know, near a week or more from a sale, waiting to be moved south. And they've got decent facilities. Lairg hasn't. And, you know, some of the island abattoirs haven't got the any fields to actually hold them on. And there are disease and health risks in actually doing that. And that's another issue you've got to take into account. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move to a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Just to return to the issue of continuing professional development and just to get a bit more from the round table, the views on the power to provide for CPD and whether there are any particular areas that CPD would be required or encouraged. I don't know who wants to take that first.
I'm going to bring in Liz and then Tara.
Thank you. So this overlaps a lot with the Commission for the Land-Based Learning Review, where there are a lot of recommendations and discussions around why training in this sector is different and more challenging than the standard models. So, for example, there are now fewer delivery centres, they're further away, the standard KPIs and funding requirements struggle to meet that with agriculture and the land-based sector. It's going to affect the seasonality effects, the standard training models, the time of year, all of that is complicated. So I was interested that the focus was on CPD rather than necessarily kind of wider training. But there also hasn't been a kind of culture of CPD, continual professional development, in Scottish agriculture compared to some of the other areas, such as Wales, for example, where they have Farming Connect and they have the kind of standard models and the requirements for recording of the CPD. So I think there's a lot of learning that we can take from other countries as well on which areas to prioritise. I agree also on the soil side as being an immediate priority.
Thank you. Tara?
Yeah, I very much echo everything that Liz has said. I think, you know, we are looking at a huge transformation of our agricultural system. I think that's come up already. You know, we really are, to achieve the objectives of this bill, we are looking at a big change in practice across the whole country. So even if people aren't used to yet being kind of part of a sort of CPD system, that, you know, everyone is going to need to change and learn new things. And that CPD is going to be essential for that. So it's great that there's provision for that under the bill. I think that what counts as CPD is quite important. You know, there's very good evidence that the way to get farmers to change practice is, you know, peer-to-peer learning, knowledge sharing, learning from each other, seeing what's worked on other people's farms. That's how we bring about actual change in practice. So I think it's really important that, you know, yeah, there's more integration of not what's currently called knowledge transfer and what's called training, and that both of those things count as continuous professional development. So obviously some things like health and safety, you need a very specific certificate and that needs to be supported. But yeah, if we're talking about broader change to regenerative practices, that's going to need a huge element of knowledge sharing between farmers. And David mentioned earlier the knowledge sharing project that we've been a part of with the Crofting Federation as well. And we've seen, you know, that it's been really successful getting groups of farmers together to basically train each other to support each, we don't use training, it's knowledge transfer, but to support each other through that. So if there's a way that CPD can include that peer-to-peer knowledge sharing, I think that's really important. And I think the other thing is to look at, in terms of models of how CPD is done in other countries and the kind of carrot stick approach. I know that, for example, in France, it is different in different regions, but there's, you know, every farmer has access to something like €3,000 a year for CPD if they want it. So that's just kind of available. And we have a system for very specific groups here, women in agriculture, for example, which is great, but that isn't available across the board. And if we are looking at a real change in practice, we might need to start thinking at you know, how people can access that and actually making that available to everybody.
Thank you. I've got Cathy.
Thanks. Yeah, I think continuation of those kind of ideas that CPD should be much broader than sitting down attending courses, because there's a whole growth area on human behaviour change or changing practice that's come from human health understanding, but it's now being applied more broadly, and that if we understand what why people behave the way they do or how we might make that change, that directs us towards what mechanisms we might use. So some of that is education, and some of it's incentivisation, and we've talked a bit about that through the schemes, but there are other methods that you can bring about that change in practice. And I think, you know, having a very restrictive view of what CPD might be would limit the opportunities to bring about that broad range of change. So I think really understanding some of the background to why humans behave or practice in the way they do and what influences that change can, I think, be a real strength. That's something to target funding into the right areas to bring about those changes.
Just before I bring Nigel in, are you suggesting that what is currently in the face of the bill is potentially too restrictive because of what people understand CPD to be, and it doesn't include potentially farmers getting together around a kitchen table or having a pint and discussing something, as we saw worked so successfully after Foot and Mouth? Do we need to have that mentioned on the face of the bill?
I think those peer-to-peer learning are amazing about and transformative in terms of how you get information to people. And I think lots of people learn from seeing it and then practicing it and trying, rather than, you know, I think health and safety has come up a few times. You know, most of us have probably done a health and safety course, and I'm not sure any of us learnt much or changed our behaviour on the face of it, but we ticked that box. Sure, it wasn't your course. But you know, finding ways that actually engage people to make people want to do something different is absolutely fundamental to making this work.
Thank you. Nigel, then, bring
yeah,
back.
I mean, I suppose, in short, I mean, I think that it is too restrictive, and that, you know, people have actually said peer-to-peer, you know, activity is probably going to be quite valuable or is equally or more significant. I suppose my appeal is not to actually do it around centres of excellence or knowledge hubs like Focus Farms or Monitor Farms. By all means, continue with them, but we want to reach everybody, and that probably means having you know, peer-to-peer activity within local communities, with a facilitator, a local facilitator, maybe a young person bringing the community together, which would be partly social, but would also allow that community to focus on particular issues that they want to share. And I think that there was a pilot done in Arran on this basis several years ago, which was, you know, extraordinarily successful. But it needs, you know, that different model. Looking at the other side of CPD, you'll probably, you know, people like Cathy and Vera have extraordinary knowledge and depth in specific areas, which is, it can be quite inspirational. And if we do get CPD or presentations, it's often by generalists who are actually drawing down that information and distilling it down into some dull format for farmers because they're stupid. What you want is to actually get, you know, people like Cathy and Vera there as well to speak directly and actually really challenge farmers and get them to push the boundaries and innovate and actually draw down their information to come up with their own ideas. Make it exciting. Don't give them the same old story, which we get, you know, month after month from various advisory services. And I'm not knocking, I think the SAC advisory service is very good, but there's another aspect which we've got to go a bit further.
OK. Liz, then I'm going to bring in Jim.
Thank you. Just to come in there with the CPD, I think CPD is what you make it. I mean, I think the educational sector is calling it CLPL now, Continuous Lifelong Professional Learning, I think. That's the latest acronym. But I think what you were saying there as well is really important. A code of practice informs a framework for education, and then it's from that you have packages of learning. And then how they're delivered, I think there's a real opportunity to link in the plans for the farm, the advice they've received, and then connecting that to specific training and learning opportunities, because that way you really get to see the impact of the advice. At the moment, those are held completely separate because of funding and legislative issues in the past. I think we've got opportunity here to connect those together.
Jim.
No matter.
Okay.
I'll think about it later.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Cathy, sorry. I beg your pardon.
I'd just like to say, as we move to more agroecological focus, there is a need to build that knowledge of ecology in all levels, from basic agricultural courses right through. And sometimes there is, it needs to be done in a sensitive way. So I know in the past our students have felt alienated sitting in ecological modules that are finger pointing and blaming farmers. So it needs to be done in a sensitive way. There is a lack of knowledge of these basic processes that underpin production, such as your nitrogen cycle, species interactions. And I think peer-to-peer learning is definitely great. I've seen it work really well. I've also seen it spread misinformation, so it needs to be sense-checked. We need experts to be there to just put the cap on some of the misinformation that's spread.
Thank you. It would appear to me that there's a lot of ability to use the stick here. So there's language in the on the bill that talks about requiring a person to undertake particular amounts of CPD, monitoring enforcement requirements to undertake CPD, and appeals against decisions of the minister relating to requirements to take CPD. It all seems very stick, and there's not a lot around what you guys have just mentioned at the moment, which is all very much about the desire for farmers to undertake that training to do their job better. It all appears to be very stick heavy. Is that the right approach?
If you don't want to be there, it's going to be of no value. So I think that the stick is you know, maybe there's some extreme areas and like health and safety, if you don't have the ticket, you can't do the job. That's fair enough. But I think for you know the CPD we're talking about, or the peer learning we're talking about, we've actually, I suppose, changing the industry. For goodness sake, don't be waving a stick. You've lost before you start. You know, you've got to win hearts and minds.
Cathy.
I was going to make an analogy with animal training. In welfare terms, we think about R+. So you reward, you reward, you reward, and that in animals always works better than a big stick, and I would submit that it works also with human behaviour.
As a former farmer, I can assure you that the same applies when it comes to training for farmers. The stick certainly doesn't help. Liz, did you want to have a final word on this topic?
Yeah, I think there is a stage, though, because there's a massive culture shift that's going to be required, and we have a lot of people working in the sector who are amazing at what they're doing, but we also have a lot of people who were told, you don't need to go to college, you don't need to go and do the training courses because you're just going to be working on the farm. So there's a lot of anxiety also around taking on training, taking on learning opportunities. So I do think there's a balance to be struck, because it is a long journey that we're going to be on for this in terms of encouraging people to take
that's
training.
That's where your official advisory service comes in.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Vera and then Tara.
Think about the carrot. Probably it's partly the language, how the bill is framed now. The carrot is the subsidies for all the different services the farmers are going to do. So that's the reward, the money. And probably it's just a way of phrasing it that we are going to support you, give you the opportunity and money and access to experts and your peers to provide those services for which you are going to be paid.
Thank you, Tara.
Yeah, I think there's something about what we've been talking about the different approaches to CPD as well that make it, you know, I think really it is true that if you're told you have to go to a certain course and you won't, you know, you've got to do that, then you're not going to learn very much from that. But if you're offered a whole range of different ways that you might want to engage with CPD in a more, it's almost a framing of it, framed as an offering of all these different opportunities, that's very different from being like, you must go and do this course. And it makes people be able to choose the ones that are relevant and useful and interesting to them, and they'll learn so much more.
How about Cathy and Liz again?
I was going to say, there are other rewards other than just money. I think there is your status, your understanding, your feeling that you're doing good, that you are responding to market signals, that you are
Getting the approval of your community, there's lots and lots of rewards that you can get from engaging this. It's not just about money, there are other things as well.
And finally on this point, Liz.
Just a plea, though, that we do need to record it, because if we're going to measure the effectiveness of that training, if we're going to make people realise what they're doing and the value of that CPD, it does need to be recorded.
OK, thank you. And our final thoughts, the last question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So I've been thinking about... We've been talking about linking this to the Good Food Nation Act, and I think part of the challenge is how do we get more people to afford healthy, sustainable food. So I've been thinking around the whole issue of sale price, and maybe this is for David and Ross in terms of organics, but for everybody. And I wondered if we need the Scottish Government to have a power to subsidise not just the production, but also the sale price of certain foods, like in particularly fruit and vegetables. And perhaps that price subsidy could be applied I don't know if this would be possible to apply just to fruit and veg grown in Scotland or grown through regenerative methods, and could it offset the premium that producers should earn for using the regenerative methods?
Lorna?
I do think that there will be potentially a cost to moving towards more regenerative practices, and I'm thinking from an agroecological point of view, it's about fair food for everyone, and it's about not passing that cost on to the consumer so everyone gets the same opportunities. And it's how, you know, perhaps it is a commitment from the government to have a certain percentage of more agroecological produce in schools, hospitals, etc. That's worked well in countries like Cyprus. Or perhaps it's taxation somewhere else. I wouldn't like to say fisky, but something like that.
Thank you. I've got David and then Ross, Tara and Nigel.
Yes, to address the point, Ariane, I think we would be supportive of that. And I think in Henry Dimbleby in the National Food Strategy made similar recommendations around the point of sale. And I think there are strong public health arguments for that when it comes to nutritious food that's been produced in a more sustainable way. And one of the unfortunate things that with the way the system is at the moment, that producers like Ross, who are producing food to organic standards, there's a lot of additional cost, which some of that is to do with the cost of production, but a lot of it actually sits within the supply chain, and it's the higher cost of distribution and processing, etc. And some of that's due to we're not really operating at the economies of scale that the conventional is. So we need to find a way of you know, internalising some of those external costs from more intensive systems. So I think that's something that government should be thinking about, not just in Scotland, but at a UK level as well.
Thank you. Ross?
As David says, one will follow from the other. I mean, if there's a greater consumption of organic food, the supply chains would follow. I was very disappointed. I think I'm right in saying East Ayrshire have abandoned their Food for Life programme.
Driven by costs.
Yeah, so there we are. We're going backwards instead of forwards. Yeah. And that was a flagship scheme, you know, there you are, Food for Life into schools. Bryce Cunningham got the plug pulled that he was going to be spending money in vans and stuff, and he heard kind of overnight that they pulled the plug in the thing, and he was, you know. And to me, that just speaks of another issue, of course, which is local authority funding and the local authority devolution to local authority to raise their own funds for these things. Because, you know, to be pulling the plug in something like that so they're getting cheaper ready meals from Booker or whoever, it doesn't seem very progressive, you know.
Tara.
I think this question of food access is really important. I think it even comes down to back to the objectives of the bill. High quality food doesn't include anything about who that food is accessible to, how, you know, normal people in Scotland are having access to that food. So I think that thinking about food access in this context is really, really important. And yeah, we would support what Ariane was suggesting. I think it's also worth, in the context of things like fruit and vegetables, though, it's worth saying that, you know, the fruit and veg sector receives almost no subsidies. And part of the reason that it's so expensive is it's really not supported at the production stage, specifically the smaller scale, sometimes more organic end of it, of the scale, market gardens, who produce really great, healthy, large amounts of food on small amounts of land, receive pretty much no subsidies at all. So of course those products are going to be expensive, whereas other parts of our food system are very highly subsidised at the production end of it. So I think that there's a role to play in at the production subsidy size too. You know, if we want cheap, healthy fruit and vegetables for everyone in Scotland, we need to start subsidising the production of those so that they can be available at cheaper prices. I think we've got put various proposals forward for how to subsidise that, so I'm very happy to talk to anyone in more detail about that. And I think the other thing is how much is of the value is actually coming from, you know, the supply chain, how much money the supermarkets are making. So I think the idea of a subsidy, I think it would have to be very careful that a subsidy doesn't just end up subsidising the supermarket, subsidising the middlemen, which is what happens to some extent with the subsidy system as we have it now. Okay. The supermarkets can pay the farmers less because the farmers are receiving subsidies, and the supermarket profits at the moment in the cost of living crisis are extraordinarily high.
Okay, thank you. Nigel.
Yeah, thanks. I guess it's worth looking at culture, in that, you know, fruit and veg have been priority, a public good, I suppose, of trying to increase our consumption. If we look back to 2007 as a baseline, we actually grow less fruit and vegetables in the UK, and the retailers sell less fruit and vegetables in the UK than they did in 2007, despite all the campaigns. So, you know, don't underestimate the challenges of changing behaviours. They're not going to go well. And I think the last point that Tara made, about subsidies, is they tend to be drawn in by retailers rather than either the consumer or the primary producer. On that basis, I'm not entirely sure that this is a very smart thing to do. What may be a better or more targeted way of fostering culture change and actually increasing access is, if you are going to spend money, spend it on procurement for schools to ensure they have excellent food and a more diverse diet. And I think that would be a better way of spending the money. Even if that money doesn't benefit the producer, at least it's producing a public good and maybe changing minds. I suppose my other thought is that all food producers in Scotland or farmers should be producing quality food. All of them should. The standards of this, I would say that they probably do now, but the standards that are going to be actually mapped out in this next reform should mean that all the food is quality food. So we shouldn't actually be cherry picking and say, this particular commodity or this particular sector is quality food. And I think that's really important politically, to actually mean that all of Scottish producers fall into that category. And I think the other thing that's really important is that there's going to be really significant changes as far as production systems, as far as biodiversity, as far as climate change and soil management over that period. Now, there's a really important that in some way, and I don't know how you do it, that politically that is ring-fenced, those actual improvements, the value of them is ring-fenced to the primary producer. They're not hijacked by retailers who demand those systems and then charge the consumer for it. If those real improvements are being met, then and the retailer is going to use them on the label, then they should be paying a premium for that product, a supplement on that commodity price for that quality. And at the moment, we're already losing the battle because retailers are demanding certain welfare or ecological standards. They're demanding their producer group to do it. They're taking the credit and they're taking the money. So it's quite urgent that that's addressed.
Thank you. We are rapidly, while we're over time, I'm going to bring in Vera and then Kirsty.
From a social policy and environmental policy perspective, intervention at the consumption level is definitely desirable and can be very effective together with production level intervention. And this type of intervention has really two legs.
One is the subsidies for those who can't afford, and subsidies on those products which are more environmentally friendly or coming from smaller farms, but also the taxation part. And a green tax can be providing that revenue stream for these redistribution, and the green tax can actually be raised in the food chain by taxing those products and producers who provide much less of the services of the public goods we need, biodiversity, rural communities, climate change and so on. And at the moment, what Tara raised a few times is that there is a very strong perverse incentive in the structure of the cap, the European cap, and what we keep is the direct payments, because we are siphoning a lot of money into producing products which require a lot of land and come with high greenhouse gas emissions, instead of pushing that money towards those products which are more nutritional and also comes with less environmental harm.
Thank you. Kirsty.
Thanks. I agree that we need to reckon with externalities, and I also acknowledge what others have said about the power of supermarkets. I just wanted to add that the trade deals that have already been and are currently being made by the UK government, and then exacerbated by the UK Internal Market Act, they can be seen as a barrier to Scottish farmers improving animal welfare, because if they do, they could be at a competitive disadvantage to products coming in from other countries with lower standards or who haven't made those product those improvements. So I think it's definitely important that the agricultural and good food nation policies try and figure out mechanisms to rebalance that.
Thank you very much. I'd say again, once very conscious of time, but I think I would like to give you all the opportunity to raise anything out of the bill or the next steps we take in developing agricultural policy. If there's any burning statements you'd like to make, now's the time before we bring the meeting to an end. Anybody like to
Take the opportunity?
Well, let me just see if there's... Is there any of the witnesses got any burning... I'll bring in Nigel.
I know this is an enabling act, and that's all, but I would make a plea to the committee to actually try and ensure that on the face of the bill there is some sort of a high-level indication of the actual direction of travel. The bill is scoped to do anything. Farmers need to have some sort of certainty or some sort of indication of where we're going, and I think it's really important that you do that in the face of the bill, and it's done in plain language, which is defined as a farmer would understand it.
Okay, thank you. Tara?
Yeah, really back up what Nigel said, and I think that that's important that that happens at this primary legislation stage, because this is where we have all this consultation and engagement, and we have these kind of conversations, and that won't all happen to the same extent in the secondary legislation. It has to be in the primary legislation. That direction of travel needs to be defined.
Thank you. And very briefly, Rachel.
Well, just I'd like to recognise that we need to be looking at the limitations of the EU at delivering on climate change policy in agriculture as well, because so many people have kicked back on the it's called the Farm to Fork initiative, and some of the organic producers have now found that their products are no longer niche. So I think we need to be very cognizant that some of it is not working. And some of the examples have been lauded in this room today as being, something that we should aspire to. But actually, we need to look at the other side of that too.
Okay. Any final comments? No? Well, thank
you. Convener. And I will promise to be brief. I fully support the idea of being able to support people to buy local food in all its forms. But will that not fly in the face of the WTO? Will we not come into conflict with the WTO?
There's a question. Vera.
I have a very quick answer. I'm not an expert on this, but I believe that you can pay your producers for non-market benefits. And if we consider that, there is a quite wide range of payments which fit into the WTO rules.
Non-market benefit. Let me think about that.
all what we are talking about, biodiversity, water pollution, reduction, animal welfare, climate change. So everything for which we don't have a private market.
Okay. Thank you. I'm sure that's a question we'll follow up with. Thank you very much, everybody. That's been a mammoth session. There's been a huge amount of information relayed to the committee members that we'll use in our future deliberations of the bill. So thank you very much. I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow you to leave before we move on to the next item. Thank you. We now turn to consideration of a consent notification for the Sea Fisheries International Commission for the Conservation of Atlantic Tuna, Amendments Regulation 2023. Do any members have any comments on the notification? No. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notification being included in the UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? That concludes our business in public. I now move into private session.